Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus, how mighty is your name, Lord Jesus, you are heaven, you are heaven to me, Lord Jesus, you are this glorious liberty. You are the glorious liberty. Lord Jesus, I yield to you. I yield
to you.
Lord Jesus, come now, take your rule. Come now, take your rule. Jesus. Oh. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. My Redeemer. My Redeemer. I live for you. I live for you, Lord Jesus. You are heaven to me. You are heaven to me, Lord Jesus. The glorious liberty, the glorious liberty. There is a place that God the Holy Ghost desires to bring us to, but we have to desire to go there. It's where the movings of the Spirit of God, the outworking of the power of God, the glory of God, the manifest interaction with Him, His deeds, His working, His presence is more important to you than anything. And it becomes so much more important to you than anything that you give yourself to doing it, to seeking Him, to laying hold on what He has. That's the dividing line, because I believe that everybody can see how glorious and how wonderful and how awesome and how amazing it would be to be in heaven or surrounded by Him. For me, I've experienced the moves of God enough to know that heaven is here now. I've experienced the moves of God to know a difference between just organized religion and the movings of the Spirit of the Lord. Tonight I pray in the name of Jesus that you begin to grab a hold of faith in God, and it moves you beyond all the things that we think about, all the things that we believe that we can do, to start being captivated by His presence and allowing Him to move through you. There's so many distractions that you're going to have to learn how to ignore them. Hallelujah. There's so much information, so many opinions. You're going to have to learn how to, you're going to have to get your ignorer working better. Ignore it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Well, you know, I want to just allow you to be able to flow in the Holy Ghost, move in the things of the Spirit of the Lord. The more you get to minister to the Lord, the stronger the anointing becomes. And then you get to minister, when you begin to minister on His behalf, you engage in a whole other level of the dimension of the anointing being expressed in your life, the power of God taking a hold of you. It's wonderful, it's glorious, it's heavenly. We don't want to leave anybody out. And we are so blessed for everybody who has labored so much. You know, there's no volunteers. Everybody's ministers. Did you know that? I was so blessed today of how many people were ministering in the house of the Lord, ministering to the things of the kingdom of God. And watch what God will do for you, through you. You can be seated. Hallelujah. Listen, I want to Can you imagine being in a church that is 1.8 miles wide and 1.8 miles long? How long do you think it takes you to get from the back up to the front when the altar call comes? They say that if you run really fast and you're not all the way to the back, you can make the altar call in 8 minutes. But that's a sprint. It's 3 kilometers. It's about 1.8 miles. And I want you to go ahead and put that up. I want you to go ahead and start working now. That way, in a few minutes, you'll be there. Hallelujah. Praise the technology. It's actually supposed to be better than what it is, but we didn't get it. This church, just go ahead, just roll it. Just go ahead, just play it. Turn the volume way up. I want to hear it.
And just begin to bless his holy name. Go ahead, give him glory, give him honor.
This is Pastor Ed DeVoe.
Give him adoration.
I'm going to tell you a little bit about him. Go ahead, guys, just
bless the King
got
of
feedback.
Kings.
It's not them, it's us.
Bless the Lord of Lords.
I want you to take a glimpse of simple faith. I want you to take a glimpse of pure faith at work.
Let him hear your
Somebody
voice.
Said, how can there be hundreds of thousands of people in a church building that's 1.8 miles long and 1.8 miles wide?
Praise the Lord of Lords.
Because what's going to happen in this meeting,
praise him.
And just with real simple,
praise him.
Pastor Adebo is going to do what he's doing right now.
Almighty God.
And people by the tens of thousands are going to be healed.
One who can do mighty things.
You say the Lord told me there's someone here tonight, you can't breathe. There's many people, and he said he heals you now. He's going to go through this. He's going to talk about healing and signs and wonders and miracles and holiness and living in purity and living in heaven now that we're the kingdom of God people, that we're now in the realms of heaven. Hallelujah. And people are going to experience heaven.
Thank you, Father.
Listen to him. And when they start worshiping, there's probably, who knows, this particular thing, this is a particular conference, this is just all their leaders. You have to have a special invitation to be in this meeting. I think there's maybe 300,000 to 400,000 people there. Plus there's that many more outside plus. But yet their everyday meetings are like this. Start at 6 in the evening, go to 6 in the morning. And if anybody told them that they were involved with an occult, they would ignore them. They would pray over them, get them delivered from the demon spirit that's speaking through them. In America, listen to this, settle my case permanently, Lord.
This very night.
People have various cases.
King of glory.
Blind. There's a whole deaf section.
You might see
somebody interpreting to the deaf here in a minute. Settle my case tonight permanently. Look at that. You look at 1.8 miles back there. I pray that you know, I have put this up on my Facebook. Keep the volume going.
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah. I put it on my Facebook. I want you to listen.
Please settle my case
permanently. What a great prayer, eh? Huh? Yes. There's more faith, more pure faith going on in that than anything else. Why are there many people there? Because Jesus is there.
Amen.
What happened?
Thank you, Father.
A few men of God laid hold on God. Simple faith. When Pastor Adepo first began in the ministry,
Jesus,
he didn't even have a pair of shoes.
Mighty name, we have
now
prayed.
They're building a university right at this moment in time. They're building a university that
mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah.
You know what I feel?
Hallelujah.
I feel the fire of God. He might not sing it, but I can feel the fire.
Mighty God. The great I am.
Their choir is like a mega church. I think it's like 20,000 people. Just the choir. The choir. It's like 20,000.
Hallelujah.
And when they start worshiping, there's not a person not dancing in that place. I want you to, there's a bunch of YouTubers. I want you to listen to this.
The great I am.
Because this is what God's doing. I was thinking today,
hallelujah.
I need to make a video of all that God is doing to the earth, because it's huge. Africa, Asia, India, China. The things that God's doing to the earth is huge. Bhutan, Burma, South Pacific. America sitting wallowing in its religion, in its deadness of its churches. while God is moving in great signs and wonders.
Father Almighty,
Papa Olodumare,
listen.
Greater than the greatest. Higher than the highest. Older than the oldest. Wiser than the wisest. Stronger than the strongest. Glory be to your holy name.
Somebody said, how do you know what he's praying?
Accept our worship
in Jesus'
name. Because
when I see somebody get a hold of God, I'll start praying their prayers. I'll start dancing their dance. I'll start moving their moves.
Thank you for all you've done for us thus far. Thank you for what you're about to do now.
How simple that is.
Please accept our worship in
Jesus'
name.
There's no telling how many people are raised from the dead just in this one meeting. Just in this
tonight,
one meeting.
Father.
Every meeting, people are raised from the dead.
In the last
every sign, every wonder, every miracle. That's why hundreds of thousands of people are in the meeting. They're coming from all over. Because it's not, maybe it's happening or somebody's bragging it's happening. It's because it's happening. Every disease.
Do something special.
Jesus is there. Do something special.
Settle our cases permanently.
Settle our cases permanently. Do something special for them tonight.
Heal our land.
Look at that.
By the time this service is over, let every one of us sing a new song.
Ha! Hallelujah!
Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Let somebody shout hallelujah. Shake hands with two or three people and tell them tonight is my night, you know. And then you may please be seated.
I think you said there's 39 babies that have been born today in the meeting. And when you got that many people, you got all kinds of things happening. Every service, you got babies being born all over the place. He said the total is like 89 since we've been here for 2 days.
The kingdom of
the boys are ahead. This is a boys' meeting. We're hoping that the girls will catch up. There's the choir. That's just a part of the choir. The choir is like 20, 30,000 people. It's a mega church. It's just he promises them that they will all be singing in heaven because they've been doing such a good job.
22 children were born.
The simplicity of the music and the sound of heaven that is there. I mean, come on, people. Listen, I pray in Jesus' name, every one of you, just grab a hold of what God's doing and run with it. You can turn it off because it goes for an hour and a half. And then there's dozens more. And now they have a TV channel. They're building a university right now that will be on the same level of Oxford and Princeton and Yale and Cambridge. And it's just amazing what God is doing. I mean, it's a whole, you know, come on. Just imagine. They say that all in the area where the government owns property, whatever, it just, you know, it's tough. It's like, you know, big, huge potholes. The infrastructure is terrible. You know, the electrical lines look, you know, disgusting. They're all tangled, look like cobwebs instead of, you know, organized electrical lines. As soon as you cross their property boundary, it's just like a first world country.
Wow.
There's the one problem that they were having is they still haven't counted the offering from July. This was just said just a couple weeks ago. Yeah, we're still behind. We were having problems counting the offering. I mean, because we receive an offering, you know. And everybody who's giving an offering is blessed. And then he begins to curse all of the strategies and seizures of the devil that is keeping people from getting jobs and telling them, equating that sickness and disease is hooked up with poverty, and that the reason that people get hit with disease and sickness was just to create a greater poverty for them. And then he gives all these examples, and then he curses the thing. And what ultimately happens is you got a whole bunch of people prospering and being in health, and when nobody else has jobs, they have jobs. And it's just simple faith. And I want to talk to you tonight about simple, pure faith. It's unadulterated. It's unpolluted with all of the compromises and with all the things that we allow in a Western society. And I pray that tonight, as I'm ministering to you about pure faith, that you'll decide that you'll want some. And you'll begin to recognize what happened was this man just went up into a place and he began to seek God. And he says, God, he began to cry out to God. Oh, God, I want to take hold of you. He just had a very small ministry and there wasn't a lot going on. And you know, he fasted and he prayed until he bled. Until he encountered God, he would not go until he encountered God. I think it was something like 70 days. No food, no water. It's impossible medically. No food, no water. But he already had a hold of God. He had a hold of God enough to recognize that God is there. He's there. See, the biggest, one of our biggest challenges, we don't have a problem getting God to hear us. His ears are open unto our prayers. He hears us. Amen. He has no problem hearing us. The big issue is that we don't believe he hears us. As soon as you begin to know and believe that he hears you when you speak and you know God just heard you, when you praise him, you know that God just received that, the whole dynamics of everything begin to change. We make it all God's fault. Not God's fault. We're screaming and hollering and acting like he can't hard of hearing. He's not hard of hearing. We're hard of believing. Pure faith, unadulterated faith, faith that is not contaminated, faith that is not defiled. You know, the Lord has called us to be pure, and to the pure, he's made everything pure. In other words, to the pure, he makes everything that we desire. To the pure, everything that we want, all that we want is pure. We just want pure. But to defiled, there is nothing pure. It's all contaminated. It's all just a lust for more iniquity, a more evil, trying to hold back yourself, trying to put a lid on the can of worms, trying to control and contain unholy desires. The Lord doesn't want that. He wants a relationship. He wants to bring us into relationship with him to where that we become empowered by him in such a way that all the things that he's doing, all the things he has is our desire. It's all that we want. It's all that our life is about. We're not interested. We make terrible employees, so to speak. In the sense that the job is secondary. Of course, God makes us good employees. We keep the job. He'll bless us because we keep him first. The only reason we're going to get fired is because we're telling everybody about Jesus. Walk around. Our face might be too bright. They might say, you know, we need to put a damper on you like you do on a lamp. To begin to have the joy and the presence of God begin to be expressed in God's people's lives rather than in the place of the church. This is what you have an opportunity. Forget about anybody else. Forget about other denominations, other groups. How about you? Are you willing to take up God and the opportunity that he's made available for you to where that you're going to have pure faith? I want you to open up your Bibles with me tonight and look in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 5. And I know that maybe tonight you might be willing to hear, and you might say, well, it was a great message or a good message or I kind of like the message or whatever. But the reality of it is, what is it that you're going to do with the message? Because there's laws to faith. Pure faith is something that is so simple. It's something so real. It's God, you're here, and you've made a way for me to know you, and you've made a way for me to walk with you, and I want to do that. Lord, you hear. And you made a way for me to be able to know you and to be able to walk with you. And that's what I want. I want to be able to see you. I want to be able to interact with you. I want to have those things which you purposed me to have. Lord, I know that the harvest is plenteous and the laborers are few, and I want to be a part of that. I want to be a part of the kind of laborers that you purposed when you prayed that prayer, when you made those things known to us in your word. You know, Jesus was in the midst of healing everybody that was oppressed of the devil when he said those things. He was in the middle of seeing the blind cured and the deaf cured and the mute and the crippled and the diseased and the oppressed go free. And he says, look at the harvest. Look how plenteous of people just pressing in. Just like, look at the harvest there in that meeting. People just pressing in. People so needy. Folks don't know where to go to get their needs met. The only thing they know to do is go to the doctor, go to the psychologist, go to the lawyer, go to the other programs that are out there offered by a governmental system, by a human system, because somehow we've come up short of being able to provide the goods. We said, you know, that there was going to be clouds. There was going to be rain, but we were clouds without water. And what a disappointment it became when we pronounced that there was going to be a moving of God and God would touch you, but yet we didn't have enough of a simple, pure faith in God to be able to see the cure and the results that God wanted to be made manifest right there in that encounter that we had, or the encounter that people had with us. I want to talk to you about pure faith, simple faith, faith that is not polluted with desires for the things of this world system, things that are not, faith is not polluted or compromised with other interests, interests like mammon. Mammon would compromise you. You can't serve God. You can't move in faith, in pure faith, and serve God at the same time. You can't. Pure faith is all about letting God be God, letting Him be master, let Him be who He says He is in our lives. And then when we say He's God and He's Almighty, how can we respond with anything else than utter obedience and fear and trembling before His presence? Because look at who He is, and look at what He said He would do, and He's not a liar, and He's not unethical, and He's not unfaithful. He's going to do exactly what He said He would do. And when we don't have what He said that we're supposed to have, then we have to look at our life and say, okay, God, there's things that got to be right, made right in my life.
Yes, Lord.
The story goes is when Pastor Adepo took hold of God, the Lord told him, he says, draw a picture of a man in the dirt. He drew a picture of a man, just stick man head, stick arms, stick legs, stick body. He said, now wipe it out. He said, and then God said, that's what I will do to you if you take my glory and profane it. Because he laid hold on God and stepped into the glory. The Father says, I'm jealous over my glory. There's not a lot of people who have that kind of glory, that kind of manifest presence of the Lord in their life, because of an unwillingness to live completely abandoned for God, to do it His way, to live for Him. You know, a friend of mine had a meeting with Pastor Adepo. He sleeps about 3 hours a night because they're always having meetings. And so his meeting time was 2 a.m. And it goes like this. There's pretty well, it's a different kind of life. Is being just fully captivated by the things of the kingdom of God. I'm telling you right now, dear people, if you and I would take hold of simple faith in God and begin to lay hold on Him, if our heart just gets right to lay hold on Him in worship, we it's like we want to skip over the fundamental basic things and go for some, you know, idea and imagination that has it's really irrelevant to the relationship and what God's called us to do right now. If we'll just take a hold of God and begin to step into an intimacy, a fellowship with Him right now, to where that we begin to express a thanksgiving in the praise and an adoration in the dance and in the shout. It's just God just here, and He's so real to us, and that's the inspiration of it. It's not any other factor involved. To where that we wake up in the morning, He's just so real to us, and we allow Him to continually fill us. And when we say that we're going to be filled with the Spirit, which is what God has commissioned us and commanded us to do, means that we're literally going to be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire every day. I mean, it would be a breakthrough to get people to come to the meeting in expectation to be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, to where they place a demand upon themselves of that which God has commanded and what God has ordained, that they will not let go of it. They will not let go of the meeting. They will not let go of their expectation until the fire of God falls upon them in every meeting. But people don't live that life. They live a religious life to where that they do certain things and they have certain qualifications of what they think it means to be the servants of God, but it doesn't match what God said in His Word. It's not being baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. It's not having the expressions of God flowing out of you that looks like rivers of His glory, rivers of His life being expressed through us, where we're consumed with God's interest, where we wake up in the morning, we find ourselves just burdened for the lost and then filled with the divine authority and insight to be able to reach them. We're not even there. We're not even on the fringes of it. We're not even touching it, because our life is so filled up with other things, worldly, earthly, mammon things. God has no real opportunity to get much through to us. We have to lay hold upon eternal life. We got to lay hold on this realm by saying, I'm going to shut this other stuff out. I'm going to break off this thing, whatever it is. You know, when Pastor Adepo, when God told him to make a stick man and wipe it out, he said, the first thing it is, he says, I am removing from off of you the way men perceive you. The way men perceive you is what Satan has done to run interference against who you are. And And we live in that to some degree. You know, I love the simplicity of Paul's life as he describes, I am what I am in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I am what I am by the grace of God. This is what God has done for me. I didn't do it for myself. He did it for me. But the grace of God was not given to me in vain. I wasn't just a willing listener. I didn't just get excited about hearing the message. I wasn't just excited about the encounter that I had with him on the road to Damascus. I wasn't just excited about the events that took place at Ananias' house when the blindness that had come upon me was removed off of me and I was baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. He said, I labored more than all, everyone else, everybody put together. I took a hold of the reality of the encounter that this is all about God and his kingdom against Satan and his lies to destroy human beings, to destroy souls forever. I laid hold on the power and the glory that has been brought to us through the cross of Christ Jesus, through the power of his resurrection, and that became my whole life. I gave everything that I was and everything that I have. I suffered the loss of everything, he said to the Philippians. I've suffered the loss of everything, and I count it as dung for the excellency of the glory of God that I might win Jesus. Amen. That's what we've seen in various different times. You know, I think back when I look at this, I think about the sacrifice of men. I think back about when a man who was a multimillionaire in 1906. In 1906, to be a millionaire in 1906 would be like being almost a billionaire now. He was an insurance salesman. He had everything going for him. He took and he gave away all of his money. And he bought a one-way ticket to Africa. His name was John G. Lake. He was touched by the fire of God. He didn't need no counseling. He didn't need persuading. He didn't have all the people around him tell him to save something for when you get older. He gave away all that he had to the kingdom of God. Bought a one-way ticket to Africa. And through him, God began to seed a nation with the exploits of signs and wonders and miracles. Because the exploits of signs and wonders and miracles that John G. Lake did when he went to Africa, it is shouted throughout the nation even unto this day. It was such great exploits. And then God sent another young man who was willing to just leave everything behind and all the other opportunities that he had and go and give himself on the mission field. And this young man's name was Reinhard Bonnke. Once again, God seeding a nation with what it looks like, the signs and wonders and miracles. All signs and wonders and miracles are is just you and I just getting a little bit closer to the reality of the presence of the living God, because wherever his presence is, death and disease and sickness and torment flees away like darkness flees from light. That's all it is. It's not some special ability. It's not some special power. It's not some special favor. It's just somebody who's stepping in closer to interacting with the reality of a living God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Who comes to fill up our lives. Somewhere, sometime, you and I are going to let this opportunity that God has given to us become bigger than the lust of the flesh. It will become bigger than the lust of the eye. It will become bigger than the pride of life. It will become bigger than the temporal things that you might have for just a little while, but will perish with the using, where you take your youth and your energy and your ability and you spend it all on yourself and miss out on the divine opportunity. It is amazing to me how God still at any age is still willing to take somebody. I don't care how old you are, God will use you. You know, I was at a meeting not too long ago, and there were a lot of older people there, and the Lord just had quickened me about the Hebrides revival, about how two women, an 82-year-old and an 84-year-old, so had a relationship with God. They knew how to pray. They knew how to lay hold on the power of God. They knew how, with simple faith, to interact with heaven, to interact with an unseen realm. And through their persistent and prevailing prayers, the Hebrides revival was born. And this, all the rest of it is history. I mean, there is a place, but it will cost you everything. And what do you mean it will cost you everything? Jesus said, unless you lose your life, you cannot have it. You will not find it. And he's literally saying, unless you lose your life, you can't have my life. You can't have the eternal life. That is the context. People almost make it mystical. Unless you lose your life, you can't find it. Like somehow it's some mystical discovery or some unique thing. No, the Lord displayed it. He described it. Man must be born again, born of the water and born of the Spirit, born of the Word. This new creation, this wonderful divine nature, this wonderful new beginning that Father brings to you and I, that so many of us, every one of us here tonight, we responded. We have responded to God and we've allowed Him to work the miracle of salvation in our life, but we've been trapped. We've been held back. We've been limited to various different degrees. And it's about time that you and I begin to engage in the conflict with spiritual wickedness. That's why Paul said, I've said all these glorious and wonderful things to you. I've ministered all the spirit of wisdom and revelation to you here in this, the epistle of Ephesians, so that I can bring you to this conclusion. And so he says in chapter 6 and verse 10, finally, brethren, and in conclusion, in other words, in summary, and this is why I've said everything that I've said up to this point, be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. Just to think that you and I have that privilege, that we even have that access, to just think for a minute that you can be as strong as the Lord in His power and in His might. That is just amazing to begin with. What? What? Said what? Because people wanted to say, oh, we're going to sin more or less every day. With that kind of an attitude, you will die in your sins and you'll spend in a place called, you'll spend eternity in a place called hell, because that's what God says. Christ Jesus came to deliver us from sin, and we know that everyone who is born of God does not sin and keep himself, and the wicked one cannot touch him. And somebody gets all offended by that. I get encouraged by that. Somebody feels obligated by that. I get empowered by that. Somebody feels somehow overwhelmed by that. I feel so blessed and set free by that. Come on, people. Come on, people.
Hallelujah.
That there is a place to be taught in God. You and I, we live in a realm of the love of ease. We live in this atmosphere of slothfulness. Got the hiss there. That's the serpent. We live in the realm of being able to make choices, to prop up our feet. We don't have to concern ourselves about anything. We need something, we'll just go down to the grocery store. If we don't have enough to get the grocery store, we'll run over to the handouts at Uncle Sam and get something from the government. Take care of us. Who needs to pray? But what happens if there's a people of God who begin to move in simple, pure faith? Faith on the basis, first and foremost, is that you agree with God. When the Lord said to Abraham that he accounted it unto him for righteousness because he believed God, the word that is the Hebrew word that is used there is amen. And amen is the word that we use when we say amen. And the same expression and the same meaning that we have today when we say amen is really the definition of amen. You say amen because you agree. Faith is found first and foremost in agreeing with God. It's agreeing with God, but then it goes to a whole nother level, because now you are willing to walk with God, and it's an abandonment to trust God and wholly trust God. It doesn't matter what's happening, what you're going through. You cleave unto Him with purpose of heart. You look unto Him, you say, no, I will not turn to the right. I will not turn to the left. I will not go to option B. Oh God, I trust you. And Father shows us a radical commitment in the life of Abraham. It is amazing to me how people try to excuse sin and disobedience and use Abraham as a model. I mean, my goodness, that's just a brain-damaged approach to the Bible. I mean, what a radical display of consecration and sanctification to the will of God. He went out not knowing where he was going. He left everything behind. You talk about selling out. You talk about leaving all of your security. Everything. I said, leave everything. You can't take it with you. And he's speaking volumes to you and me. We want to take things with us. You know, it's like I was saying this morning when we were consecrating baby, my grandson, Kate and Ruthanna's first baby, Ezekiel James. There is such a display of power and glory and beauty and splendor described in that story of Hannah with Samuel. This shows us what's the result, what the reward is going to be when we consecrate something fully to God. She just took and consecrated a baby that was not yet conceived in her womb. She consecrated it to God, and then she followed through in that consecration, and it wasn't easy. It's easy when you're not having conceived a baby. But now he's going to be weaned, and you've had him for three, four years. And he's the darling of your life. He's the definition of your existence. He's the meaning and the value and the worth of who you are, especially in that culture and at that time. over 3,000 years ago. She takes that precious baby that she consecrated and she takes him up to the house of God and she gives him to Eli. And she could have said, oh, I can't take him to Eli. Eli's not walking with God. He's not right with God. And look what his sons, Hophni and Phinehas, are doing. They're leading Israel into the worship of the Queen of Heaven and doing all kinds of evil, immoral things around the worship of Asherah. No. Her commitment was to God, not to men. To the house of God. And what she said, she was going to follow through. And look what happened. Oh, we talk about Samuel 3,000 years later. What the model of Samuel's life and who he became and what he became and what he did and his impact he had upon a nation and the formation of a nation and the rooting and settling of the prophetic voice in the midst of God's people. One act of consecration produces a great outworking of the power of God in the midst of the earth. What happens if we'll consecrate our life? The Lord did something for us. He made it possible for us to be accepted to God by God. He made it possible for you and me to be acceptable to God, something we could never earn, something we could never have, something that we were strangers and foreigners and aliens and cut off from and had no rights and no hope and no promise and no covenant. And then we take that for granted. But oh, what happens? All of a sudden, you and I would respond to this wonderful opportunity that we have to be able to live and dwell in a oneness with God Almighty, to live in the holies of holies, to stand before Him in all of His glory, which the angels tremble and won't even behold, and stand there with all boldness by the blood of Jesus Christ. There's got to be a change come into our lives. It's going to cost you. It's going to cost you everything. You no longer live. I am crucified. I no longer live. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but it's not me alive. It's this life of Jesus, a slave, a servant, willingly consecrated to doing only what Father says, to walking in the model that Christ Jesus presented before us. Learning how to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit. Learning how to mind spiritual things. Learning how to be clothed and endued with the anointing of the person of Jesus Christ. Somebody talks about the anointing of Elijah. Well, yeah, that's pretty fascinating, you know. But the anointing of the only begotten Son is far above the anointing of Elijah. The anointing of Jesus Christ, where you and I are to put on the Lord Jesus Christ. We have the ability to be clothed and endued with Him, to make no provision, to fulfill any other human desires. And I know people want to make it a contest between the devil and God and say lustly, fleshly lust. But yeah, you could translate it that way. But he's really just talking about all human desires. Because I'm going to tell you right now, the pride of life just as we're about as anything else. I'm telling you right now, the cares of this life will choke the word so that you'll be a false witness. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Because you go off doing your own thing, not doing His will, doing your will. So earthly desires encompasses the whole thing. It's not just the demonic, it's the self-interest. And we just want to overlook that. It's amazing to me how almost it seems like in the church, Christians have got to become 90 years old before they even start asking the question, wonder what it means to deny yourself. I mean, in a practical application, so that I'm going to do it tomorrow. And I'm going to do it right now. To no longer live for my own will, to live for my own interest, but to live for His will. Because I'm going to tell you right now, suddenly you've got a level of responsibility that you can't blame on the devil anymore, because Jesus denied His holy self. And if there was any self that was so pure and so glorious and so worthy of being yielded to, it had been Jesus' self. And He said, I'm not doing myself stuff. In other words, He fundamentally brought it down. I'm not doing my will. I'm not seeking my own desires. I'm not going with my own plan. That's what self is. My will, my plan, one of the biggest things that stop the flow of God, the move of God. If a move of God starts, one of the first things that Satan uses is he besieges the move of God. If there's a move of God in your life, Satan will besiege it. But he can't do any more than what God allows. Huh? And if you just walk in the wisdom of the Holy Ghost, he won't launch his attack off, and it won't get off the ground. You know what I'm saying? Huh? But he uses the spirit of offense. People getting offended. You're so easily offended. When I'm preaching, I watch the spirit of offense hit people all the time. Boom! Here I'm preaching, knowing power of God's going forth, Spirit of God's going forth, but because people have settled out to do their own thing, Satan is able to take advantage of that, and then they take offense of their, because their wrongdoing is being pointed out. Instead of it bringing within them and working within them a Holy Ghost conviction of fear and trembling, where they fall down and respond to God, say, oh God, I'm wrong. I want to be right. Forgive me, Lord. Wash me, strengthen me, change me. The pride of life has hold on them. And all they want you to do is tell them that they're wonderful, that they're great, that they're special, that they're first place in heaven, that everything they're doing is good. They don't have to change anything. Continue on as you are. Clap, clap, everybody. Come, please stand and applaud so-and-so and everybody else too. Each person is going to get a turn. You're good. You're wonderful. Keep doing what you're doing. Just bring more money to the meeting. You're good. You're wonderful. Just keep doing what you're doing. God just loves you so much. You don't need to change anything. You're just accepted like you are, even though you're a rascal. Of course, you know, you're not a rascal. I'm just hypothetically going down the list. But that's not the word of God. The word of God is repent. God grants to us to repent. He commands everybody to change. He says, everything about you, I do not like. Yeah. What? Yeah, everything about you, I detest. I want you to die. And I'm going to provide a way for you to die in Christ Jesus so you can be made anew, so that you can be everything that is holy and acceptable unto me, so you can live holy and acceptable unto me. That goes over like a lead balloon. In the spirit of humanism, in the spirit that the demon power has deceived mankind with, I like me. I think I'm great. You know, God likes me too, and I can't believe you don't. I can't believe you're having a problem. No. The Lord put everything about our life is under the stronghold of a demonic reign. It's the old man. It has to be put to death. It is that which is cursed. It's that which is condemned to an eternity without God because of Adam's sin. And we've all sinned, even though we didn't sin after the same likeness of what Adam did. That same sin came upon us and began to work its fruits within our life. And the consequence of that is death, marred by the demonic. Amen. Marred by the demonic. The Lord said, I'm going to make you new. Amen. And everything about your life has to change. Because nothing about man is acceptable unto me. He said it over and again. He loved Moses. Moses was willing to respond to him, call him Moses. But he said, Moses, don't you come near me. You stay right there. Don't you come near me. I'm holy and you're not. Don't you come near me. So he said. That's what he said. Go read it. God made it very clear in the Old Testament the distinction between who he is and what man is, and that man was unacceptable. And he says, you tell my family out there that I've sanctified with my presence, that if they come anywhere near the mountain, they're going to be killed. Because they are not set apart. They're not sanctified to be able to come and interact with me on that level. I am completely other than you are. You are completely unacceptable to me. He said over and over again, the law proved. The law was, that's why Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 that the law was the minister of condemnation. The law ministered condemnation. The law ministered your other. And that's the whole theological concept of God has transcended other. He's different from us. Now we live in the ministry of righteousness because he removed that. He took it away. He brought forth a new creation. He brought forth the opportunity for you and I through a miracle work of grace to get a new heart and a new spirit. Now to be taught of God as newborn babies, where we once were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. Now we're born in righteousness to be shaped every day in holiness, to be taught of God, to be taught his ways, to be taught his glory, his majesty, his purity. Pure faith, simple faith that begins to recognize he's here. I'm his temple. He's made me one with himself. He's made me holy and acceptable. He's commissioned me to live out the life of Jesus. He's empowered me to go in his stead as his ambassador, as the minister of righteousness, to go and cast out devils, to lay hands on the sick and they recover, to raise the dead, to do all of these works that he said over and again that we're supposed to be doing, that somehow we want to say that it's not applicable. Because we want to self-justify rather than be made righteous. We want to self-righteous. We want to justify our state, even though it doesn't conform to the image nor look like the word. all of a sudden we begin to move into a realm where we say, no, Lord, I want heaven now. People say, I want heaven later. I don't want to die and go to hell. Well, are you going to live in heaven? Because what happens is people don't want to live in heaven. They act like somehow some kind of, you know, terrible life. You're going to miss out on everything if you're living for God and living in heaven right now. That is deception. That is deception. If you're not in heaven, you're not dying and going to heaven. If you're not been born again and made a new creation and filled with the Spirit of the living God, you're not on your way to a place called heaven. Heaven is the place where God dwells. It is the place that you and I are allowed to access right now, that we're supposed to live in continually. It's a place, I mean, you can't describe heaven any more than where Jesus is. Where is Jesus? Some people think he's like a planet. Some of these theologians have had, I don't know what they had, but they're talking about some planet that God's on. You give me a break. Give me a break. You spend too much time trying to explain God to us. You need to come and know him. Amen. You need to come and know him. He's made you and I his habitation, his dwelling place. You're going to tell me anywhere he's going to live is something other than heaven? You've got two choices, heaven or hell. Now pick, which one is it? God's not living in hell? He's not living in hell. Oh, no, there's an earth realm. No! We have been delivered from this present evil world, praise God, and translated into the kingdom of the dear Son. That's what Paul said, Colossians 1:13. Somehow we're going to have to begin to identify the entanglements, the tentacles, as it were, of the realms of earthly interest and self-interest and even demonic things that hold us back. I believe that Satan has put a similar cloud over people's own lives of the way they perceive themselves. A depot God had to remove from off of him the way others perceived him. But how do you perceive yourself? God wants you to begin to have the eyes of your understanding open so that you can perceive yourself as someone one with God, filled with his love, everything that is holy and acceptable and precious and beloved by him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Everything that he's empowered, everything that he's ever wanted. I can just come to Father and say, Father, I'm everything you ever wanted, and I want to be that fully. Why am I everything that he ever wanted? Because I've been created anew in Christ Jesus. I'm not defining my life based upon who I am. I'm defining my life based upon who Christ Jesus is. And I read about what Christ Jesus is, the Father. And suddenly all of those things, all those mind-blinding spirits, all those deceptive lies that try to distort the truth and create another image that we then believe and agree with. It's about time you get over in Christ Jesus. I'm crucified with Christ Jesus. Nevertheless, I live, but it's not me, it's Jesus that lives. He's living in me. Huh? Jesus is heaven, and Jesus is mine. So I'm living in heaven right now. Hallelujah. And in that place, simple, childlike faith begins to work. Simple, pure faith begins to operate in our life that allows us to begin to interact with the Holy Ghost, because we're not hoping someday to be saved and hoping someday to be acceptable to God and hoping someday to be able to hear the voice of God, hoping someday that we'll be the temple of God, hoping someday that the Spirit of the Lord will lead us. That's doubt and unbelief. And James put it forth and he said, listen, there's absolutely no way that you're going to be able to get anything from God as long as you're wavering. You're going to have to fast and pray till the wavering stops. You're going to have to lay hold on God till the wavering comes to an end. You're going to have to take a hold of the authority that is in Christ Jesus so that the demonic can no longer sway your opinion about who God is and what he's done for you. Amen. That deserved a whole lot more than just a little grumble of an amen. Shame on you. You need to lay hold on eternal life. Yes. I'll tell you right now, if I was in your seat, I'd have been standing up. I might have run around the house on that one. Amen. Why don't you imitate me? Why don't you just start acting like those who are full of the Holy Ghost. Why don't you pray our prayers, sing our songs, dance our dances, shout our shouts, have our passion, have our pursuit. Why? Because yours not getting anywhere. Come on now. Come on now. Reality of it is, unless you learn how to speak, you never have simple faith. You never speak to the mountain because you don't have simple faith. Oh, that's the mountain. It can't be moved. It was there. God put it there. Why should I move it? And the reality of it is, it's not only literal. I believe it's absolutely literal. I don't believe it's hyperbole. I don't believe it's God. Hyperbole is a nice way to say that God's exaggerating. It sounds like you're some kind of an educated person to be able to even say the word, and then the definition is that much more absurd. It's literal, but it also has to do with so many spiritual applications of things standing in your way.
Yes.
It's about time you learn how to smash things.
Yes.
It's about time you learn how to slap things down out of your way.
Yes.
Rather than being run over by every wind of doctrine and every lie that Satan propagates, his thief has come to kill and steal and destroy. He's a thief. He's a lying, cheating thief. Huh? He's a lying, cheating thief who's a rebel against God and hates everything that is holy and demands that you fall down and worship him. And the acts of worshiping him is just simply sin. It's all he needs. It's all he wants. It's taking his mark. You don't need no 666 or some kind of little potato chip put underneath your skin. Some kind of covert operation as somebody brands you for the Antichrist. I'm going to tell you right now, when that goes down, it's going to be, people are going to know exactly what's going to go down. The worship of the Antichrist will be so erotic. It will be so deceptive. Its power, its sway will touch every appetite of humanity, and people will rush to worship him. It will be irresistible. It's far worse than the stuff that people get carried away with on the internet and all the other little stuff. You can't stand against that. You wouldn't stand 1 minute in front of the Antichrist. Because what's happening then, at that time, God has removed all the restraint. He's removed all the restraints that he's put upon Satan. In 1565 years, Satan had brought men to a place. It's the first 1565 years from the day of creation. God, the day that God created Adam and Eve, in 1565 years, Satan had so little restraint upon him that he had brought all men to such wickedness that God said, "It repents me that I have made men. For the thoughts and the imagination of the heart is only evil continual." How many people were on the face of the earth? Could have been 10 billion people. God had one man. He found one man. And because of the result, he had eight souls, because it was the family of one man who was perfect before him. He said, "Noah is perfect before me." He didn't say Ham, Shem, and Japheth. And their wives. And he said, "Noah. I found Noah." Now there's a restraint. In over 4,000, almost 4,400 plus years, Satan has not been allowed to bring mankind to the place that he was able to bring mankind in 1565 years. But that restraint is going to be removed, and it's going to be removed completely, completely off of the satanic. The hinderer of iniquity will be removed. The restraint of the mystery of iniquity will no longer exist. God will say, "Let it go," like saying to the tide, "You don't have to stay here anymore. Let this, the water, as it were, rush across the face of the earth. Let the tide of the demonic rush across the face of the earth. No restraint. Now, God will not allow you to be tempted above what you're able." That restraints are completely removed. All restrictions are off. Everything is removed. And that's the level of iniquity that will be taking place when God pours out his wrath upon sin. You cannot have simple, pure faith with sin going on in your life. You can't. No. It's going to be contaminated. It's going to be polluted. You're not going to be able to clearly hear and clearly see when you're not walking in purity. Purity allows you freedom from all condemnation and guilt and shame. A purity that comes by the blood of Jesus Christ and is empowered in our lives by the Holy Ghost, where we now, having begun in the Spirit, are made perfect by the Holy Ghost, where we walk in him and live in him, where we love dwelling in his presence, we love dwelling in the fire. And as soon as the joy seems to abate a little bit, we ask for the fire to fall afresh. Huh? As soon as the love seems to wane, we say, "Spring up, oh well," hallelujah. Because we have a criteria by which we live, a fruit that we demand in our life, a relationship, a result, an outworking of a relationship that God has perfectly described. scribe. No man is ignorant of these things, but people want to just go off and live their own life as they choose and act like it's not that important. Jesus said, if they don't walk in the love that I'm showing you, they're not my disciples. That's what he said. You can read about it. He said it in a very unique way in John chapter 13, but that is the summation of what he said. You should know that them by their love. You should know that they are my disciples by the way they walk in love. And he's describing his love. Now I want you to look with me in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5. And really, I'm just giving you an overview. I'm just helping you understand, people. There's some things that you're going to have to understand to be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might to be able to stand against spiritual wickedness. You're going to have to recognize that within those categories is mammon. Within those categories are the cares of this life, deceitfulness of riches, the pleasures of this world, which Jesus, in the context of Matthew chapter 13, for example, wasn't identifying necessarily calling as sin. He was identifying as self-interest. He wasn't so much identifying in any way the things of seeking after what you should wear and what you should eat as sin. In Matthew chapter 6, he was identifying it as self-interest and that which would be running interference against you seeking the kingdom of God if you prioritized it in your life. You hear me? Yeah. You seek God, you trust him, simple faith, to provide for you. To meet all of your needs. And you don't let all those things get in your way. They don't become factors. My wife, you know, she's interacted with me now for 32 years. She knows me. She knows if she starts bringing up any hurdle or any reason why we can't do the impossible, I'm going to go, I'm not listening to you now. You are now in the realms that does not belong to God. What you're saying does not matter. I am ignoring you. Hey, and she'll turn right around and she'll say, oh, she doesn't do it like, you know, when we first got married, you know. So I said to my, we were in a meeting the other day. So where's your wife? I said, she's home sleeping. I've only got one of her. I get one of her for all of my life. And that's it. And I'm going to take very good care of her because I want to make sure. This is it. That's all I get. I get her. And, you know, in the early days, she was raised in mammon. She was raised in a Roman Catholic church. She never knew nothing about stepping out and walking in this supernatural place where you just speak it out and start doing it and you don't have any money to do it with. She thought you had to do everything with money. She didn't know you could do it in faith, that you could move in the supernatural realms of God. You could speak it. You could call it to come, that you took your money that you had in your pocket and this is how you receive supernatural supply. Take your money that you have in your pocket, put it in the offering basket and watch what happens. A miracle will take place. Wait a minute, you just gave away what we had. Yeah, so that more could come. Watch how it works. I was in a meeting the other day and hallelujah. I was at a board meeting with a minister, particular minister, and the Lord spoke to me because he was pulling on me. I said, yeah, well, the Lord wants to give you a key. He wants to teach you how to give more lavishly. And he's like, well, I thought I was giving. He said, no, I said, no, you are giving. God wants to give more lavishly. And then the Holy Spirit said, show him how. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Write checks out of your need. I don't just write checks on behalf of the church either. We write checks on behalf of what we have. And sometimes it doesn't just ever once in a while. We clear out the entire bank account. Everything. People look at me and say, hey, how do you do what you do? How do you have what you have? Because we constantly clear out our savings account and our bank account and put in the offering. And as soon as we get a savings account, the Lord tells us, we had a savings account, biggest savings account we've had in years, right? $2,500. I said, don't put it in the bank. Just hide it somewhere. And let's forget about it. So we hit it somewhere and we just forgot about it. All right? And then I'm in a meeting and the Lord said, give it. I said, honey, give it. Hallelujah. And that was something that we were going to do, something that just believing God for. But you know what? I discovered that if I obey God, he supernaturally works things like this building,
right.
Like this property. Yes. I drive on this property, and I praise God for the traffic jam that's going to take place on this property.
Yes. Yes.
People trying to get in here because of signs, wonders, and miracles. I got to get you straightened out because there's got to be more than one or two people connect with simple faith, pure faith, know how to flow in the Holy Ghost. Because otherwise, I'm only around only so long. You're going to be around more probably than I am, and you can't be giving them some other gospel by the way that you act and the way that you live, the way that you talk and the way that you praise, the way that you dance, the way that you move, the things that are coming out of your mouth, the way that you pray. The way that you believe God, the way that you give, the way that you love. And I praise God that there is a great flow of love in this place and servitude. Father wants to take it to another level. He wants to rule over all. He doesn't want to rule over half the words come out of your mouth. He wants to rule over all of them. Amen. He don't want to rule over half the thoughts that come into your mind. He wants to rule over all of them. Because he wants to get rid of all that stuff that is causing death and destruction and pain and torment in your life and fill you up with peace and joy and love and life and God, where everything's good from the morning rising of the sun to the time that it goes down and all the night in between. Father hasn't commanded us to walk in his ways for his sake. He's done it for our sake. I'm going to tell you right now, God will be good forever without you. He will still be holy. He will still be enjoying. There will still be celebration. There will still be shouting. There will still be eternity, even though you reject him. He doesn't need you and me to be good. Amen. To have it all. He had it all before we ever came. God created the eons by Jesus Christ. I know it says he created the worlds by his son. The Greek word is eons. It wasn't 6,000 years ago, by the way. Eons! Hallelujah. This is a big thing we're involved in. This is big stuff. This is big, big, big stuff. This is big stuff. Woo! This is mighty stuff. Somebody says, can the nation of America be saved again? Can there be a great awakening again? Yes, I'm looking at God's material to bring it to pass right here tonight. Yeah, I'm looking at it. I'm looking at it right in this place here. God, the Holy Ghost is stirring you. Don't put him off. Because if you put off the stirrings of God, they won't stir again for a long time, and maybe never. You don't just turn a deaf ear to the whispers of the Spirit of the Lord. This is shake a nation. I love telling you the story. Richard was here just recently. Somebody was here, a minister, a preacher was with him. I said, let me tell you how God will work. He was talking about faith. He was needing it. I said, let me tell you how God will work. I said, I was out cleaning horse stalls. What we call poop, scooping poop. Talk about who's in charge of who, you know? Who's serving who? My goodness, you're there to take care of everything the horse needs, and you're thinking, wait a minute, I think this relationship is upside down. What am I getting out of this? At any rate, Richard calls me in church telling me about somebody inviting him to the nation in Nepal, and he was thinking about going. And I said, you thinking about going? What is wrong with you, man? That place has been in captivity since the beginning. I mean, the seeds of the gospel have never taken root in Nepal. Now there's an opportunity. The king has given his power over to parliament. There's an opportunity to go in and test the freedom to preach. And when I'm saying that, the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and said, you're going. Here's how faith came. Faith came to this, like this. This, here's a preacher saying, I've been invited to Nepal. Here's the call of Nepal comes into my spirit. Hey? Suddenly I realize I'm going. I'm upset at him that he's thinking about not going or thinking about going. I get the call. I'm stunned by the power of God. This is how faith works. This is how it happens. It's just an opportunity. I could have brushed it off. But it gripped my spirit. The next day, a preacher, a pastor has never come to my house. And to get to my house, you've got to go down a long, long dirt road that I personally graded myself. And sometimes it was good and sometimes it was bad. And your car, if you just washed it, it was didn't look like it was washed for years after you come down my driveway. He shows up at my house, knocking on my door. I said, what are you doing here? He said, I don't know. He said, I just felt like coming by and seeing you. I said, come on in. I said, the Lord's telling me I'm going. I said to him, I said, I believe I'm going to Nepal. He said, you're going to Nepal? Really? Who do you know in Nepal? I said, I don't know anybody in Nepal. He says, I know somebody in Nepal. Here's his telephone number. Bye. I got to go. I mean, it's like 5 minutes. See, it's how faith comes. It's how the supernatural events come. I call up the guy. I simply say, hello, my name is Mark. A friend of yours gave me your number. I'm coming to Nepal. And I wasn't real excited. I was like, it's more in the morning. Hello, my name is Mark. I say, my name is Reverend Dr. Pastor Mark. I've been doing this thing and that thing and the other thing, and I'm this and I'm that. I just said, I'm Mark. I'm from San Diego. Your friend gave me your telephone number. And it wasn't that excited. Hey, hello, I'm Mark. Hi. Friend of yours gave me your telephone number. And I thought I'd call you and let you know I'm coming to Nepal. It's about like that. Why are you coming to Nepal? I said, because the Lord's sending me. How do you know? Because he spoke to me. What do you expect to happen? I said, well, listen, if one person gets saved, then that's good enough for me. He said, okay, bye. That night, God gives him a dream. The next day, he calls me up. Who are you? I said, I'm Mark from San Diego. because the Lord connects all the dots. All you got to, I'm like going, okay, yes, sir. I'm crying out, oh God, Lord, send laborers into the harvest, for the harvest is plenteous and the laborers are few. And God, I want to go too. I want to be used by you. I want to do it your way. I want to be a part of that which you've ordained. I want to be part of this greatness. I want to be part of this big, big, big thing. This glorious thing, to live the life of Jesus, to walk in the ministry of Jesus. And now it comes at a most inopportune time, scooping poop. Comes at the most inopportune time. I'm the money. I'm no other way. I'm no means to go. I can't look in the bank account. Oh, we got it all taken care of. Just because mammon's not even in simple faith. Mammon is not a part of the calculation of trusting God. The arm of flesh is just a stench in the nostrils of God. He says, curse is everyone who trusts in the arm of flesh. This is somebody said, oh, they cursed me over there in Tijuana. They made a voodoo doll on me, and I can feel it. It's like somebody's poking me with a hot knife. Listen, you don't need nobody in Tijuana to curse you. All you got to do is trust in your own human ability, and it'll put a curse on you like no witch doctor or voodoo man could ever do. Simple faith, mammon cannot even enter into the realms. You cannot serve God and mammon too. That's all about trust. Serving God is about trusting Him, believing who He is, that He is, that He's here, that He exists, that He is, His being is here. It's a very weak translation. Most translations, because when you read it in the Greek language, you just understand. You know, it's like everybody's always talking about God says, I am that I am. He's literally saying, it's really me. He realized, I mean, it's really me. It's like when they came to get Jesus in the garden, you know, everybody wants to make a big deal. He says, I am. He just said, it's me. And they all fell over to backwards. We're looking for Jesus. Where's Jesus? Are you Jesus? It's me. Bang. Oh, no. I am is much more powerful than it's me. No. God is just God with whatever verb you use. Yes. He is God with whatever preposition you attach to him. I mean, to believe that he is, to say that it is without faith, it is impossible to please God. For they that come to God, you want to come to him? Yeah. Then you must believe that he is, that he bees. That he's being, that he's existing, that he is, that he's here, that he's now. You have to have all of those words. Otherwise, you're just kind of like still got it off somewhere that's, you know, foreign to you. Maybe you might get there if you're good enough and you pray hard enough. No, he's here. He came and invaded our lives. He came and grabbed a hold of us. He came and sought us out. He came and chose us. He came and called us. Thank you, son. Amen. I'm up here screaming and hollering by the anointing. Somebody can scream and holler back.
Yes.
By the anointing. Amen. Instead of sitting there, man, I'm running your race, digging your ditch. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Somebody's like, what do you mean digging your ditch? Digging a ditch like Elijah dug. to contain the water that's about to flood the place. And people, if you're going to stand around and watch somebody else do your work for you, that's fine.
No,
it's not. It's fine, because I'm going to still do the work. No, you're right, it's not, because you're not going to get what's the results.
Right.
You're not. You're not. Because you're willing to hear, but you're not willing to respond. You got to lay hold on this stuff.
Amen.
It's got to be bigger to you than your own life.
Yes.
I can see you scratching to survive if you were caught in the currents. I can see the life self-preservation if I would put you in some places that we get into out there on the mission field, scratching to survive. Huh? That even, I don't care how brave you are, your knees are still smacked together. Huh? You've been praying the Holy Ghost till love dries out the fear. Hallelujah. Till abandonment, consecration to God. The more you do it, the better you get at it. The more you face death, the more you've been prepared. I might have ran the first time, but I'm standing now. I might have been a coward, duck and run, but I've faced it now. Huh? Come on, people. Come on. I'm inviting you out of yourself and into Him. Come on now. Come over here. We're inviting you out of the realm that you live in. I'm trying to plead with you. God, the Holy Ghost is trying to plead with the mentality that is confined to your experience. That then through that you try to perceive what's being said by an almighty God from a place called heaven. And you define it and then reinterpret it based upon what you can think and what you can understand. God wants to show you things which never eyes never seen, ears never heard. Neither has it entered in the hearts of men. But you've got to begin to move. You got to begin to lay hold on us. And I'll tell you right now, as soon as I seen a 1.8 mile by 1.8 mile church, I'm telling you, just like, what's he praying? What's he saying? What you eating? Not much. It's more fasting than eating. It's living a life of fasting. When you've done it, you can tell, you'll see the look. You know the look. Huh? It's not about just buffeting your body. Luxury and some more, and you know, manicure, pedicure, another cure. It's about, Lord, I want you. I want heaven. I'm not interested in this realm. I want heaven. I want out of this realm. I don't want to be distracted anymore. Let me see. I got to see. I want to see you. Lord, I want to see you. Lord, tonight. If I can behold you now, if I'm not prepared enough, if you see that if you Paul showed up to me, I'd die of a heart attack, then reveal yourself to me while I'm dreaming. We can handle things in a dream that we can't handle, you know, awake. But place a demand upon yourself to have what God has purposed. Because you don't have to, it's not hard. The easiest thing is to have God hear you. He hears you. The hardest thing is for you to believe that he heard you. And that is confounded and conflicted by all these earthly interests, all the mammon. You've got to get it. You cannot trust God and trust mammon too. That's why the offering is so important for you. It has nothing about, because I'm going to tell you right now, it honestly, you got to understand, has nothing about taking care of the lights, taking care of the buildings, taking care of salaries. It has nothing about that. It has to do with you connecting with heaven. That's all it has to do with. It has to do with you saying, look, this isn't my place. This isn't my trust. I'm looking for God to work a miracle in my life, in my heart, so I can call things in supernatural that goes beyond what anybody can pay for.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I mean, there's a lot of people, they have different things to say about Heidi Baker and different, you know, because she's a little weird. Well, all of us are a little weird.
Right.
Just what perspective do you have and how do you define words? Goodness gracious, she's planted so many churches. I think she's planted over 5,000 churches. The number of orphanages, I don't find her weird. I she's my sister. You know what I'm saying? She's the daughter of the Most High God. I don't care if somebody like does this kind of stuff. It's fine with me. I do kind of strange things under the influence of the Holy Ghost too, you know. I get to rocking around a little bit. So will you.
Yes.
Huh? Because I'm telling you right now, interacting with God is far, far more impactful than interacting with that light socket over there. You know, I'm telling you right now. Praise God. Hallelujah. I believe she, I'm not sure where she graduated from. I'm not sure if it was, I think it was Oxford or Cambridge. I'm not sure. Something like that. Seems like it was over in England, not here. With her doctorate's degree. And she goes to the mission field. Beautiful, eh?
Yeah.
Beautiful. Beautiful. Simple faith that has no mammon in it. It says no mammon in it. Who's going to take care of me? Doesn't come into your mind. Because you have a relationship with God. You agree with Him that He said He was going to take care with you, care of you. And now you fully trust Him. And anything that would try to challenge that trust, you cast it down with the Word of God, with the authority of God, with the power of God. Because it's an imagination that's trying to exalt itself above the knowledge of God. The knowledge of God said He's going to take care of you. Amen. He's going to provide for you. Amen. Oh, He said, according to His riches and glory, Amen. You seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these Amen. Things shall be added to you. Amen. I'm going for the adding, not for the gaining, and not for the getting, and not for the having by myself, but for that which God would gift me with. Whatever He wants of me, I willingly give. Yes. Amen. Come on, people. Because you're bought with a price, you're not your own. You belong to Him. It's simple faith to resolve yourself to it, to consecrate yourself to it, to the point that every time anything challenges that, you say, no, I'm not going with your influence. Yeah. It just takes a few people like this in America to change the nation, just a few. Amen. I'm going to be one of them. Where's the second one? I'm not impressed into this realm. I'm just going to say, I'm isolating myself from all the mess. Yeah. You know, I was looking the other day at Yitzhak Keturi, Rabbi Yitzhak Keturi. He's dead now, died in 2006. And I looked at the man from this perspective of how he consecrated himself to a dead religion. Dead religion. He consecrated himself, identified at the age of 13 years old to have a photographic memory. It was proven over and over again. Somebody give him a book to read. He could just start talking to them and tell them the page number and the paragraph and what it said and quote their book back to them. And they're just like, what? Because it's a fascinating thing to have such a mind. And he consecrates it fully to just seeking God and learning the things about God, about a dead religion. But there was something going on. He had several times and events where he went into trances and he prophesied things that would happen in Israel. And that captivated even more people's attention when he was in his 80s and his 70s and his 80s. And when he was at his bar mitzvah, a rabbi where he was from in Europe said, you'll see the Messiah before you die. So about 3 months, and you can go hear about this and read about this. This is public information. It's got a big thing going on right now among the Haredi, among the Orthodox Jews. Because he said, because 3 months before he died, Jesus appeared to him. And so he said, I'm going to write the name of the Messiah. The Messiah appeared to me. But you cannot read it until I'm dead. He died at 100, was he 120 or 125? What was he? He was old. He was born in the late 1800s. And he died in 2006. Yeah, pretty cool, huh? He would not, you would never find him even watching a television. You wouldn't find him reading anything secular. You just consecrated to a dead religion. Jesus appeared to him. He wrote it. His 80-year-old son said, no, this is my dad's handwriting. This is what he said. He said, Yehoshua, which you would say in Aramaic, people would say, Yeshua. He said, oh, we need to use it. He's funny to me. He said, oh, we need to call upon God in the name of the original, in the original language. And then they speak Aramaic. They say, Yeshua. It's funny. Well, if you're going to do the original language, man, you're going to have to go back to Hebrew. You know, because it's Yehoshua. Because his name is Joshua, translated in English, would be Joshua. But the Lord chose it to be pronounced Jesus. It's what this is God's design. Not some sinister conspiracy against God. God rules, man. He rules in the kingdom of men. He rules in heaven and in earth. He's exalted above all other powers and authority. No conspiracy happening unless He allows it. And he's watching over his word to keep it. Hallelujah. Now all the rabbis, many of the rabbis, prominent rabbis, are reinvestigating Jesus the Messiah. And admitting, publicly admitting, that their only view that they had of Jesus the Messiah was that which was portrayed by the Roman Catholic Church, which they completely write off as pagan, totally, for many reasons. But would they write you and me off as pagan? Or would they look into your face and say, Jesus, there's His love, there's His humility, there's His meekness, there's His lowliness, there's His purity, there it is, there's His purity, there's His virtue. I'm afraid that we've emphasized something just as the opposite in the Western Greco-Roman culture. We've allowed our culture to impose upon us, worldly culture to impose upon us, the way that we act, the way that we live, the way that we think, what we desire, the way that we behave, what our purposes are. It's about time to get over in culture, or having to be taught by God, the kingdom of God, the things that the Holy Spirit wants to teach you, the things the Word of God wants to train you in. But you mean I can't go paint up myself like I'm a Cherokee warrior and start screaming and hollering for the chiefs? I can't dip myself in orange and go run around screaming and hollering in a blizzard with my shirt off because I have the name of my favorite team tattooed across my chest. It happens, right? It happens, right? It's nuts, it's nuts. It's crazy, it's crazy. And you come to church. I can't believe these people. Look at them, they're all excited. What's wrong with them? This is weird. This is a cult. California cult. It's so sad. So sad. Because it's keeping people from knowing God. Pure faith, simple faith, is not contaminated with anything of the world. It's not contaminated with mammon. It's not contaminated with doubt and unbelief, because that double-minded person that's really uncertain, not true, sure where they stand with God, can't draw nigh to Him in the full assurance with a true heart and full assurance of the faith. They're wavering. God says, you're not going to get anything from me. I'll love you, but let not that man think that he shall receive anything from me. Because a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. So does God just write you off? No, He causes you, it should provoke you, say, I'm getting rid of this. God ain't going to be able to respond to me like this. God, I'm going to get rid of my double-mindedness. Oh, God, I thank You right now for giving me a measure of faith. I thank You for working in my life a measure of faith, and I'm going to take that measure of faith. It's going to be the most precious thing that I have. It's going to be bigger than my bank account. It's going to be bigger than my life itself. It's going to be bigger than any other interest. I'm going to take that measure of faith. I'm going to do something with it. I'm not going to have it bestowed upon me in vain. I'm going to give myself over it till it becomes full of faith, till it increases and becomes everything that God has ordained and purposed for my life. God speaks out His word to you now by His Spirit. Do not let it be in vain. He wants to work something right now in the earth. He's looking for some people who lay hold on Him no matter what it costs. Somebody said, what must I do? I'll do anything. I'll confront my fear and my doubt and my unbelief. I'll confront my inability to interact with God. I'll lay hold on Him. I won't live with it. I won't somehow self-justify it. I won't accommodate it. I will not excuse it. I will deal with it. I'll break off that yoke. I'll take hold of God and let Him supply those things that I have need of and establish me in the faith. Because that's what He's purposed to do. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5. Now he says, the end of the commandment. In other words, he's saying the teleos, the completeness, the fulfillment, the whole reason for it. where it all is summated, where you find yourself in it to the full. The end of the commandment. Why was it given? What's the result? If you could have it all, what does it look like? Here it is. It is love out of a pure heart. Mm-mm-mm-mm. Tonight, I want to ask you, is your heart pure? Yes. Has your heart been purified in obeying the truth? Yes. Do you understand? Without a pure heart, you cannot see God. Yes. Have you allowed God to give you a new heart? I'm going to tell you right now, there are a lot of people that struggle with that. They just don't feel worthy. They just don't seem to feel like that they're acceptable somehow. They don't feel like it was completely done in their life in terms of the work of salvation. I mean, it's just time you agree with God. It's simple faith to say, you said it, God, and it's mine. You declared it, and it's so. You made it so easy. All I got to do is call upon your name, and you said I'd be saved in my house. Acts 16, verse 31. I'm just going to get so simple with you, God. I'm just going to get so real with you, God. Not surreal, so real. I'm going to get so real and simple with you, Father. I'm just going to believe everything comes out of your mouth. Yes. I'm going to know you did it, and I know you're going to establish it. I know you settled it, and I know you finished it. This is everything God's saying. This is what He wants of me. This is just simple faith. This is what I'm expecting of you. I want you to love everybody with a pure heart. Amen. If I look at somebody and I have anything going on in my life that isn't purity, I'll shut that thing down. I recognize the demonic power. God gave us ability over all unclean spirits to cast them out. And when any demon spirit comes to you and tries to pervert God's creation, God tries to pervert within your life an abuse of some other human being. So twisted. You deal with it for what it is and don't get trapped by some kind of an emotional, physiological response that Satan has created around sin and iniquity that draws you in to where you just got to have it because of the feeling of it, the sensation of it. It's a demonic realm. It's just full of destruction. You're never going to be able to love out of a pure heart. Just to understand how I give myself to love, because faith works by love. If I'm going to understand how to give my... Because this is all about pure love. This is about simple love. This is about unfeigned love. I mean, for giving, it's about simple faith, pure faith, unfeigned faith that is found here in this place of just giving myself over to being so filled up with His love for me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That it, you know what, that kind of love immediately begins. You can know you got that kind of love because you want to be the servant to everyone. It works servitude. It works humility. That kind of love causes you to think that everybody's, you know, you esteem everybody better than yourself. I mean, you know, it's not like you think that everybody's better. You're just full of servitude. You're full of love. You're willing to lay down your life as Christ Jesus laid down His life for us. What compelled Him to do that? The love of God. A same kind of love that He wants to put, that He's put in on the inside of us, that is activated by the Holy Ghost, by our will. It's activated by our will because, say, Lord, I have the choice. I stand at the crossroads to hate or to love, to despise or to love. You know, to accept or to reject. You know, when I gave myself to the Lord, I said, okay, Lord, when I meet a person, I'm going to fall in love with them in the first 3 seconds. Suddenly, in that, coming into that consecration, I had to deal with all the things that before, I was just oblivious to. Because if you don't understand this, you're going to start running people through your little list of whatever, of expectations. And meet your little criteria, check, X, 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 check, X, X, X. None of that's the way, that is the way it goes down. There's not a lot of acceptance in the human realm. The love of God accepts. 3 seconds, 3 seconds in, no matter what they look like, no matter what they act like, whether a cone head, an orange head, a punk head, doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Whether they're just a blabbermouth or super quiet or whatever, it doesn't even matter. You're just loving them. You're letting God, the Holy Spirit, love through you. Oh, true. Because if we don't allow you to step into an understanding of a practical application of how you're going to respond to the Holy Ghost, in your confrontations and your experiences and the things that you deal with tomorrow, then it's just really You know, you've not learned anything. You've not. It's ineffective. The Word of God and the working of God is ineffective in your life. You don't know how to put into effect obedience to the Holy Ghost, to allow God, the Holy Spirit, to take control. Not your own interest, Father's interest, and only the Holy Spirit shows us to move in Father's interest. Not my will, Father's will, and only the Holy Ghost brings to me the ability to do the will of the Father and to know the will of the Father and to give myself to the will of the Father. Amen. So I have to learn how to yield to Him. He's amazing. God is amazing. He's got a great sense of humor. He said, I'm going to teach you guys how to yield to me, okay? I want you to get really happy. If you're sad, it shows you, just talk about simple. If you're sad, it shows you you're not yielded to me. Because if you're yielded to me, the evidence is going to be joy unspeakable and full of glory. I mean, he's just got this amazing sense of humor. I mean, this is great. This is a great idea, Father. I can do this. I'm smart enough to recognize the difference between sad and happy. We're on the page. We're on the same page. Same way with love and hate. Of course, we want to have love, like, kind of like, and all the rest of the gradations. It's just love or hate. God's love, not any kind of love, but the love that Jesus gave and showed us when He died for us. So ought we sure also love the brethren. The commandment of God. This is the completion of this. This is the whole purpose of it. This is the result of it. The love for the pure heart. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, j'ai la mondaille. You're standing in line for correction now. Not ducking and running. I just can't take it. I just can't take any more rejection. You just don't know what I've been through. If anybody else tells me that I'm doing something wrong, I'm just going to collapse. You don't know what I went through with my uncle and my dad and my brother and my teacher and every man in my life. I know. I'm a pastor. I had to listen to this. I would come to your church, but when you start yelling, it reminds me of my dad. When I was 4 years old, he always yelled at me, scared me to death. He's created all these problems in my life. Well, we're going to set you free. Amen. And you're going to be valiant. And you're going to be mighty in God. And that stuff ain't going to matter anymore. You're not going to live a former life. You're not going to live under the demonic stronghold of a demon spirit. You're going to be captivated by the love of God, become the servant of all, and be the first in line for correction. Because you healed. You're not all beat up and full of rejection and hurt and torment and just can't take another. I'm a collapse. Come on, people. This love of God. To move in the love of God is to feel 100% acceptable to God. And accepted by Him. And then, my goodness, it just gets better from there. I'm always telling people, come on, people, let God train you in the hardest places of life. If you can reach your cousins for Jesus, it's all downhill. You can shake nations after that. That's the hardest person you're going to have to reach, your cousin. The Lord says this. He says, a good conscience. People, I'm going to tell you right now, there is absolutely nothing better than walking with God in obedience, so much so that your heart does not condemn you. Amen. Or convict you. And because you're walking in such obedience to God that your heart does not condemn you, then whatever you ask Him, He's going to do it. You're going to have it because you do those things which are, you keep His commandments and do those things which are pleasing in His sight. When you can move out of condemnation and out of guilt and out of shame, miracles and signs and wonders begin to happen in your life. Faith begins to be effective in your life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And you don't move out of guilt and condemnation and shame because you redefine grace. That's what people are trying to do. You know what? It ain't working.
Oh, we're going to have supernatural signs and wonders because anything goes now and we're acceptable to God.
You're not going to have nothing, man, but lying signs and wonders. You Spookville for sure. It's not going to be nothing but Halloween over there. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to every man, teaching us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust and to live righteously and godly in this present world. Hallelujah. In this present world. In this present world. Hallelujah. This place of purity, not impurity. Purity, not impurity. Purity. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Prosatuki dalamosataya lika. Hallelujah. Some of you men, you know, maybe women too, you have a problem looking at the opposite sex and you know, thinking of things and desiring things that you shouldn't be thinking of and desiring. I'm telling you right now, you stand up against that thing by the purity of the Holy Ghost, and it won't be long and that won't even be there anymore, because you're going to be seeing an eternal soul that you want to see nothing but filled with the Holy Ghost and power and liberated in every dimension and empowered in every dimension in the things of the Spirit. And you there as a true brother or sister in Christ to help protect and to preserve and to keep and pray and intercede on, you know, for that cause. It's good stuff. Yes. Amen. Yes. You don't look at a person and say, oh, you know what? I just want to destroy their soul in hell. It's true. No, it made me reinterpret it. Ah, you know, some kind of lust or some kind of evil desire. Same thing. I want to destroy that. I want to be a part, participate with eating. I want to be able to participate with seeing their soul eaten out of their body. That's lust. It comes under its disguises in an immoral society. What happens if there's men of God and women of God that does what Rabbi Yitzhak Kedura did to it for a day of religion? What scientists do in pursuit of knowledge and information? Suddenly there begins to be a people that begin to act like Pastor Adeba. So I'm going to lay hold on you, God. I'm going to lay hold on spiritual laws. I'm going to lay hold on spiritual principles. I'm going to learn how to take hold of simple faith. I'm going to learn how to walk in the Spirit. I'm going to learn how to speak and it happens. I'm going to learn how to ask and you do it. Because suddenly we realize, wait a minute, God's called us to have such a relationship with Him that whatever we ask Him, He will do it. How many times did He say it? He ultimately summated His whole call of our relationship with Him in John 15:16 to that very thing, that He ordained us, that we didn't choose Him, He chose us and ordained us to bring forth fruit and that our fruit should remain, that whatever we ask He would do. He said that over and over and over again, simple faith, to believe I'm an heir of God and co-inheritor with Him, that I'm in a partnership with Him, that He's fully endowed me with all that He Himself has, and He wants to mature me and grow me in this mindfulness and sensitivity to His leading, to His inspirations. And I'm not going to get distracted and caught away with other interests, mammon interests, because I can't serve God and trust God and walk with God and agree with God and learn from God when I'm all caught up in mammon. Mammon's a big word. Somebody says, should it be translated money? No, it's bigger than that. It's all earthly interest, all human interest for your own self-preservation. It's true. It's where you're ready to sell your house. It's where you're ready to go sell all that you have and give it to the poor and come follow Jesus. And some people right now are getting a little stomach ache. Because there's still maybe a price you're not willing to pay. And you want to self-justify. I don't have to do that. God wants to bless me. Yeah, God wants to bless you. But what happens is when you bless you, it always keeps you from following God, much less getting blessed by Him. And He'll bless you far better than you ever blessed you.
True. Yeah.
But that's where now you got to fully trust Him. That's why if I could just catch people before they got anything, before they've gone in debt, before they've gone pursuing and heaping all this stuff upon their life, and say, well, just give your life to Jesus. Come follow Jesus. Get yourself completely involved in the kingdom of God. Forget about everything else. Just go with God. And now just seek first the kingdom of God and let Him bless you. Let Him give you whatever it is that you need, your house, your car, whatever you need. Amen.
Amen.
I mean, we want to see the Lord use us in so many different ways to be able to I believe one of the great missions right now is to be able to impact our culture and society in ages, kindergarten, preschool, even all the way to 12th grade, and do it by, you know, by virtual school, you know, interactive school on the internet, and change the curriculum to where it's designed, to really develop people in the realms of the Spirit, the realms of the kingdom of God, and as well as empowering them to score the highest on any SAT scores, any standardized testing to get into the best schools. Because you don't have to read something that's kin to pornography to make high scores on SAT. That's all a bunch of nonsense. Anthony, listen to a bunch of anti-Christ, anti-God nonsense to score high on the SAT scores and on the other standardized ACT and all the rest. You just got to know the tricks. He's got another important information.
Yeah.
And I mean, to be able to have, you know, higher education schools and influence higher education schools to where the people are developed, not to go and make a bunch of money for the devil and get a little tip for themselves so that they can continue to be a slave to the system, but to learn how to have business, learn how to give themselves completely to the kingdom, to serve the kingdom of God. And if they're involved in business, it's business that serves the ministry, not ministry serving business. It's business that everything that you're doing in that business is reaching the lost. It's propagating the gospel. It's declaring the name of Jesus. And it's creating enough finances for everybody that has any skill set for you can hire them and pay them as good as anybody else. And all they're doing is preaching the gospel all day. And the workman's worthy of his hire. Praise God. Yeah. He's not working for the the wicked.
Yeah.
Amen.
Faith. Somebody said, "Are you dreaming?" No, I'm dreaming. Moving into faith. Simple faith. I have a belief, I have a consecration to believing, to living out that God has empowered us to do whatever necessary to reach the lost and change culture.
Yes.
And declare His kingdom and reveal His name. But so long as the arm of flesh is so big to you, you'll never enter in this realm. So long as you live for yourself and you got to pay your bills, God can never pay your bills. So long as if you're not going to work, it ain't going to get done. You're going to go to work for the till you old and don't have enough strength to carry my Bible around. It's kind of heavy. Come on, people. Hook up with me. Let's go to Cuba. Just hook up with me in faith. Get so excited about it. And while you're excited about hooking up with me as I go meet with Fidel Castro and Raul, you know, you're so excited about it. You're just saying at the same time, I'm going to do that too.
Yeah.
I don't know what nation it is, but, you know, hey, Azerbaijan's on the list. Azerbaijan is on the hit list. And if you beat me there, I'm okay with that. I don't even know who the ruler is of Azerbaijan yet, but I will at that time. Somebody asked me the other day, have you been to Azerbaijan yet? I said, no, but say so what? They said, excuse me, I'm getting drunk. They said, somebody said, he's got a speech impediment. No. It's just that my heavenly language functions better, is more fluent now than the English language. So I'm just trying to stay in the English language rather than going over there for your profit. I said, I haven't gotten there yet because right now we've got Kashmir, we've got Cuba. You know, I started going through the list. And he said, I have contacts in Azerbaijan. This is Azerbaijan. And as soon as you're ready to go, let me know. Well, that's good. That's great. I'm not sure that that's the ones that I'm going to use. That's good. Because as soon as I hear it, as soon as somebody says, I know someone and it's the right one, it hits you. What hits you? Simple faith. We call it the gift of faith. It's simple faith. What is it? It's agreeing with God. It's trusting God. And it's a supernatural impact that empowers us. We know we can do it. Suddenly, we may be 3 foot tall, and suddenly we grow to 40 foot tall. It's like, you know, we can do it. We can do it.
Hallelujah.
I'm so excited about Cuba.
Yeah.
You know, all that's going on, you know, all that's going on right now is that when I left, where did I left to go to? When I left to go to Birmingham, they sent me a message saying they want another pastor's leaders meeting. Did you hear about that? Yeah. Did I tell you? I told you, didn't I? And because all the pastors want to know what it is that they can do, what all they're going to need to do for this crusade. You know, the stadium is 75,000 seater, and they don't. I mean, they've lived under oppression. There's not been any. Raul owns the television and the radio. So if you're going to get, they don't have a right to advertise. It's got to be, you know, Raul's got to give you his television channel and his radio station. and transportation. Well, they, Raul owns transportation. So it's not like he can go by the transportation, so to speak. You know, I mean, now it's, there's more liberty now. And so, you know what? I just got to get to faith. Raul's paying for everything.
Yes. Amen.
So, right now that needs a lot of prayer and intercession because I know that. But when I tell them that, they're going to be just sitting there looking at me going, you know, now tell us really what we need to do. No, really, it's going to, you know, you need to bring the leaders and the people who are going to work in the meeting. Raul is paying for everything.
Yes.
He's paying for the stadium. He's paying for the transportation. He's paying for the advertisement. Transportation is the biggest thing. We're going to do a celebration for all the children. That's going to be huge.
Yeah.
I mean, and we're the Lord's going to cause us and allow us to be able for the first time because the embargo is. This is even Obama can be used by God.
Amen.
Oh man, I said the other day, and you should have seen the look I got from those preachers. Even Obama can be, that was U.S. preachers. Even Obama can be used by God. He removed the embargo so that I can ship in a bunch of food into Havana to feed everybody. Otherwise, where were we going to get the food? Yeah. Obama didn't know that he was cooperating with my crusade. He didn't have any idea. I got ripped off by the U.S. government back in 2001 in our crusade in Iraq and Baghdad. They started bombing everything. It's hard to have a crusade with shock and awe going on. Right at the time of the crusade, they started bombing. At the time of the crusade, they're bombing. That's a bummer. Said the Lord is making it up to me. You Obama. What are you doing? You look at me like that. People look at me like, what are you doing? Do you have simple faith, simple childlike faith, pure faith that is not contaminated with the arm of flesh and with human interest and mammon and doubt and unbelief, and you living out your own life? Have you received the life of God empowered by him to go in his stead, to speak his word, to act on his behalf as his heir and co-inheritor with Jesus? I have.
Yes.
See, whatever I ask the Father, I'm practicing. Right now, whatever I ask the Father, I get it.
Amen.
Yes. I'm fully engaged. Amen. In pursuing whatever I ask, whenever I ask it. Well, what if you ask something that's not according to the will of God? Guess what? I'm not going to. Irrelevant question. Irrelevant question. My heart is united unto him.
Amen.
My heart is united with him in his holy and righteous cause.
Amen.
I only want what he wants.
Amen.
I'm only desiring what he desires.
Amen.
And yeah, that has to be tested, and that has to be tried, and that has to be proven, and that has to be developed in our life. And good thing is, God is preparing you into every good work.
Amen.
Do you believe it?
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm so excited about Cuba.
Yes.
I'm going to change the nation.
Yes.
I am joined in Christ's stead.
Yes.
Because he's empowered us. He said, you go. He said, you go. I'll go with you, but you go. I'll empower you. I'll confirm my word that you speak, but you go. So I'm going. So ask me for the nations, and I'll give them to you as an inheritance. That's all I'm doing. I'm just believing God. It's just simple childlike faith. It's just simple faith. It's simple faith to agree with God, to trust him for the greatness. Not the false humility to say, who am I? That's false humility.
Yes.
True humility is, oh God, you've done such great things for me.
Yes.
Be it unto your servant according to your word. That's true humility. Be it unto me according to thy word. You got to have that in the. Be it unto me according to thy word. No one can be told anything greater than God's about to be born in your belly. And nobody could have been told something greater and so beyond all that could be thought of than to say the Holy Ghost shall come upon you, and that holy thing that shall be conceived in the inside of you shall be called the Son of God, the Almighty God, Emmanuel. What? Be it unto me. Come on. To agree with God is true humility. To submit to His word and do His will, to say what God said I will do, that's true humility. Hallelujah. 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 To not need the praises of men, that's true humility. To only need what God has to say for you, that's true humility. Hallelujah. Namrata ferede prasa. Hallelujah. Hambla sifreti shikana namo. Hambra basitina lana kasana niki. I'm going to lay hold on it.
Yes.
I hope tonight that we're being salty for you.
Yes.
So that you get real thirsty.
Yes.
We hope tonight that we provoke in you to recognize, wait a minute, this power and this authority is really here. It's really available. It's yours. God wants to do far more in your life than what's going on. He's not in respect of persons. He's not said just a certain category of people can do these things. He said anyone who believes, anyone who will move in simple faith, anyone who will move in pure faith, faith unfeigned, faith not contaminated with other interests, not polluted by mammon, not polluted by sin, not polluted by doubt and unbelief. Because the only way that mammon and doubt and unbelief can work in your life is because you're not consecrated to God. Because you're not with total abandonment, said, I'm yours, oh God, and I no longer live. When that happens, when you're willing to do that, mammon can no longer work. Trusting in the arm of flesh, looking to your own human ability to supply what you have need of, can no longer work. Consecrated to the purposes of heaven. You're bought with a price, you're not your own. See, there's going to come a time, and it's already happening, where people deny the Lord Jesus who bought them. It's not that they deny the historical Jesus and the person Jesus who exists. They deny that they were bought and purchased by Him and that they're owned by Him to do only His will. It's true.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's happening. You're bought with a price, you're not your own. You're supposed to glorify God in your body and your spirit, which are His. It's not yours.
Amen.
I wake up in the morning and say, Father, I know this body is not mine. I know it's yours, and I'm not going to trespass on that which is yours. My eyes, my mouth, my ears, my feet, my toes, my fingers, everything, my eyebrows, my lashes, my knees, everything is yours.
Yes.
Hallelujah. You're God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I was listening to Pastor Debo preaching. He said, I know that the doctor told you that you were sick unto death. I tell you, the doctor is not God. Ignore him. Simple faith.
Amen.
And people obey that and they yield to that and they say, yes, healed.
Yeah. Amen.
The doctor is not your God.
Amen.
Your boss said this and that about your finances. Your boss is not your God.
Amen.
Ignore him.
Yes.
What a sermon. This sermon is entitled Ignore Him. Now the end of the commandment is divine love out of a pure heart, a good conscience, and pure faith. Faith that has no contamination, unfeigned. It has no contamination. It is not contaminated with any other interest. It is not contaminated with any other influence. It's not mixed with any other thing that exists in all of creation. It only has affection and dedication and devotion in a single eye, in a single consecration unto the living God, your maker, your creator, your father, your redeemer, your savior. If your eye is single, your whole being is filled with light, no other interest. You don't need any. It's all a lie and a deception. You don't need any. Father takes care of the birds, and you're far more important than the feathery fowl. Father, clothes the ground, which is just temporal, and you are eternal. You're so valuable to him, he's numbered the hair upon your ears and contained every tear you've ever shed in his bottle. Should you only knew it, that where you were weeping, Father was there with his bottle collecting all of your tears. You would quit weeping quickly if you understood how near he is, how he's come to inhabit our lives. How he loves his, all of his delights are with the sons of men.
Hallelujah.
Many of who don't want anything to do with him, but all of his delights are with the sons of men.
Yeah.
And he rejoices over us because he loves us so much. Because he could not win our affection, he came and consecrated himself unto death that he may redeem us. That he who created us and formed us and fashioned us and called us forth might also purchase us with his blood, that he might have us unto himself. Oh, that we would say, yes, Jesus. Your kingdom is better than the kingdom of men. Your way better than the ways of men. Your life better than all concepts and descriptions that men have imagined. That which you've invited into me into is greater and beyond all that I could have ever thought of or ever asked. And I come wholly to you, O God, to be taught to live in your kingdom, to live in your heaven, to live in your realm, to operate by you, Holy Spirit, to move in your will, to move in your interest, to walk in your light and have no darkness in me, to give myself to your truth and have no lie in me. To live fully for you, that you might live fully through me, for your life is far greater than my life, your existence far greater than my existence, and at this crossroads of decision, I choose you.
I choose you.
And the grace that has allowed us to choose him, and the beauty and reality that God moves in, the Spirit of the Lord moves in and takes control of our lives if we hand it over to him. When we say, Holy Spirit, take me and place me upon the altar of your praise and let your fire fall and let your fire burn in me. And that's just a continual interaction of a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. Just an offering. Just an aroma satanda le behisifiti tatanamotasa. To just think and recognize and see with the eyes of the Spirit that right now Jesus is that we're is as it were on his knees making intercession for us, crying out. That we would be empowered, that we would be strengthened, that we would stand up against the forces of hell that would try to defeat us. He's interceding. That we would be strengthened, that we would respond, that we would take hold of that which he's given to us, that we may stand against the temptation, that we may stand against the sifting of Satan. That we stand against the immorality and the floods of darkness. That's what Jesus does. He ever lives to make intercession for us. The Holy Ghost interceding on our behalf with groanings which cannot be uttered, that we be strengthened, praying for our weaknesses, that there will be places that become places of strength, they'll be able to stand against all the forces of hell. Father the Almighty would stand up on the inside of us and begin to speak. If he can have all of us. And in his mercy he pleads with us. He shows his love and his grace. Remember this. The blessing of God is not a sign of Father's full approval of your life. Because he causes his blessings and his rain to fall upon the just and the unjust. Causes the sun to shine upon both the riches, on the righteous and the wicked. He's poured out his spirit upon all flesh indiscriminately. All flesh. The grace of God has appeared to all men. He's come and said, come on in. He said, to peace to those who are near and to those who are far off. He's waiting for a man. He's waiting for this man, this woman, that woman to respond to him and say, okay, Lord, I'm going to live your life. I'm going to seek your face. I'm going to do what you've called me to do, and I'm going to rely upon you to do it all, for without you can do nothing. You got me now, Lord. Send your fire. I'm yours. Lord, the altar, you have built the altar. The altar is built. The sacrifice is ready. Send your fire now. You built the altar. The altar is built. The wood is laid in order. The sacrifice is ready. God wants to change your life. I spoke one word to Pat Schatz line by the Spirit of the Lord. I said, tie yourself to the altar. Tie yourself to the altar. Bind yourself to the horns of the altar. God took it. The Spirit of the Lord took it. Redefined his ministry. Because faith comes on the wind of the Spirit when the Word of God is spoken. Tonight, I'm telling you, it depends on what you do. We were in the board meeting this past week. Right in the center of it was the altar and the rope. He immediately went and got an altar and a rope. He said, tie me. And he started proclaiming and prophesying it. I'm tied to the altar. Bind me to the altar. Bind the sacrifice to the altar now. Tied me to the altar, Lord. When memorizing the verses of scripture surrounding him, many are willing to hear, only few are willing to obey. It's so easy to brush off what God said tomorrow morning. Because you're flooded with all that life, this life, temporal life, imposes upon you and demands you to do. But what if you say, no? No more. No more. No more addictions, no more lies, no more lust, no more serving myself. No more pursuing my own interests. I don't care anymore. I take everything that I have and I just bring it. I put it upon the altar. I get down on my knees and I say, Lord, I take this that you gave me. I put it on the altar for you. I give it to you. It's no longer mine. I take this. Lord, I want nothing in my life except for that which you give me. If it's holding me back from moving forward with you, then I know you didn't give it to me. I surrender it now. Yes. Everything, just name it one by one. Just go through it. Lord, nothing is mine. It's yours. Where do I go? What do you want me to do? Use me now.
Yes.
Feel me now. And the big thing that begins to happen, it isn't so much all of the details and all of the possessions. It's that you begin to say, let your fire fall upon me, Lord. You commanded for me to be filled with the Spirit. There's nothing more exhilarating and nothing more exciting than to be filled with your Spirit. So God, fill me now. And you learn how to yield to the Holy Spirit that way. And that's why these meetings, that's why it's be in the meetings. Hallelujah. Be in the meetings. Because as you're in the meetings, you stay in the meetings, you learn how to respond to the Holy Ghost and get filled with the Holy Ghost. And as you do, then you can be in your living room or wherever and get filled with the Holy Ghost, because you learn how to just respond to the feelings of God, the movements of God. Hallelujah. We're going to be in meetings this Wednesday night, this Thursday night, this Friday night. I'm going to tell, when Evangelist Tim Hall comes in, I'm going to say, Tim, I want you to hit it hard, man. He's had over 60,000 people saved just in the past few months. I mean, God uses, Father's used Tim Hall in amazing ways in his life. He'll tell you about the place that he encountered God in long fasting and praying, crying out to God in the backwoods of Australia. The place of encounter. I tell you, anybody, anywhere who's being used by God had a place of an encounter. And that encounter was by fasting and praying, by a passion and pursuit of laying hold on God. With a willingness to go, with an abandonment to do his will. Just says, I don't want anything else. Well, you can be this. I don't want to be that. I want you. Well, don't you want to be that? I don't want to be that. I want to be you.
Yes.
I want to be what you purpose me
yes.
to do.
Yes.
I want only what you have for me.
Yes.
I want to be in the middle of your movings, oh God.
Yes. Yes.
I'm going to be right there when people are being delivered and set free, and the crippled are walking, the demon possessed are being liberated. I'm going to be right there when the hearts are changed and men are broken and under Holy Ghost conviction and begin to shake by the wind of your presence or delivered from the deception of the enemy. I want to be right there, oh God, when your glory overshadows the place and the cloud of your glory steps in and nobody can even hardly see because the presence of God has so captivated the attention of the life that it become visible cloud of his glory. I want to be there.
Yes, Lord.
And then what happens? It starts working so deep in your passions, you start losing your appetite. You're not even hungry anymore. It's called lovesick. It's lovesick. You just, oh God. Lord, I want to be with you. Lord, I want you to move this in my life. I want every one of you to begin to start saying, look, you know what? I'm going to have a Bible study. I'm going to believe God to have at least 2 people in the Bible study. And it can't be anybody in the church. It's got to be the lost. Because then you begin to move in the work and all of a sudden you start seeing, oh God, God's able then, as you get into the work, God's able to form within your heart a need for an anointing to break the yoke, a need for anointing to have a moving of God, a need for an anointing to have so that people can have an encounter with God. You're in the best place you possibly can be. It's the crucible of faith. It's the crucible. You're at the crossroads where a lot of people back off. You know, oh, I had 4 people coming. Now there's only 1. Oh, I'll shut this thing down. Yeah. It's for you. It wasn't for God.
Amen.
It's the pride of life governing, not the Holy Ghost. So it's a break point. Everybody has to press in for it.
Yes.
I define success as doing what God said to do. Every one of you, start doing the work of the ministry. Every one of you. Just believe that God's going to show you somebody to lay hands on tomorrow that's sick and they're going to get instantly healed. You're going to walk by somebody and all of a sudden you just feel this deep compassion. Like Krista was telling me, she saw somebody in the store. She knew she was supposed to talk to him. She was just trying to, she excused it. She went out the car and she was still gripped by it. Gripped. Well, don't you do what you got to do when you're gripped. It happened to me. Who was with me? You were with me. Who was with me? Daniel was with me. I was walking by. We're just walking by. We were doing meetings up in Aberdeen, Washington. And we went out to a little park to see the lake. I was walking by this guy and he was getting wood for somebody. I was gripped by him. I was gripped. I knew. Okay. So the Lord says, just talk to him. And a number of things were happening, issues and events were happening, and he took off and they couldn't get to him. So I knew what the Lord wanted me to do. And this is not my first rodeo. I've been through this thing over and over again. I know the leadings of God. I know how the word of knowledge works, how discerning of spirits work. I understand. And God makes it very plain. He grabs a hold of you and you know you're supposed to talk to that person. Yeah. It's a tractor beam. And I'm like, I'm like, oh, Lord, forgive me. I'm sorry. I knew I did wrong. I should go run the thing, guy down. But he's disappeared on me. And we got to go, right? We got to go. We're late. I get in the car and the thing won't start. Guess what I did? I'm going to go find this guy. Right now. I'm going to go find this guy. I searched everywhere for him. I couldn't find him. The guy was supposed to be the tender of the whatever. Of the campsite. Finally, I knock on the door. He comes to the door. I said, Jesus Christ is calling you, sir. He's looking at me like, I'm Native American. I said, it doesn't matter to me. Jesus Christ is calling you. The call of God is upon your life. You need to respond to God. What do you want? I want nothing. I want you to understand. And he shuts the door. I guarantee you the guy is haunted day and night. Amen. He's probably already given his life to God by now. He's right. He is probably, within a week, he was a sobbing bucket of tears. Because you can't give a deliver a word like that and it don't. Burn like a fire. Yeah. He would start getting all uppity with me. I say, I'm calling the fire of God down on you right now. You say God doesn't exist. That's right. I say God doesn't exist. I call the fire of God down on you right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And then they look at you like you're all weird until the next day. Now they're trying to find where you're at. Where was that place that I saw that guy? I've had people look for me for months.
I promise you, the power of God is like a fire in your mouth. Shut up in your belly. It's going to come out of your mouth. He has put his word in your mouth. Jeremiah, I have put my word in your mouth. Speak everything that I tell you to say. He looks at you and me. He said, I put my word in your mouth and in your heart. Wow. It was the highest place a prophet could be called to. Not only that the word of the Lord came unto them saying, but that he's rather, I put my word in your mouth. Speak. Wow. Come on, people. You've been empowered to live this life. Come on. You know, I was just looking at Yachi today. Yachi, I hope you're watching. I've seen the power of God moving in her life like never before. You just persistently went after her, persistently went after her, persistently went after her, to save a soul from hell. You got to come to church. You're going to come to church. I'm going to come and get you. We're breaking this thing off of you. Listen to me. This is the powers of darkness. This demon spirit, I'm telling you right now, it's not going to ruin you forever kind of thing. People, the word of God won't return void. Just get the word of God in your mouth. Father's not interested in your philosophy. He's not interested in you adding to his word, interpreting his word, trying to explain his word. It's an insult to God. He's not happy with that at all. Speak the word.
Amen.
Look at people and say, where are you going to spend eternity? What do you mean? Christ Jesus is calling you now. That is absolute truth. Questions that God himself is asking. And they have to have a word of knowledge for it. You've already got the word of knowledge. Word of God is the word of knowledge. Hallelujah. Just be empowered. If you will just be empowered and start living this, simple faith will be developed. The measure of faith that you've received all of a sudden will begin to grow and become strong. It will increase and become full of faith. Stephen was full of faith and full of the Holy Spirit. And what did he do? What did he do? Tell me, everybody, what did he do? He did signs and miracles among the people. That's all it takes. Come. Get out your doubt. Get out your disappointment. Get out your discouragement. Get out your human reasoning. Get out your thinking. Get out of your doubt. Get out your unbelief. Get out the mixture. Get out of trying to add all these other things that God wants nothing of them. He has no value in them. And trying to have them as a part of the stream of God in your life. Let it become a pure stream.
Amen.
Let it become a pure stream of praise. Become a pure stream of thanksgiving. Pure stream of I am thine, O Lord. I have heard your voice. Breathe on me, breath of God, for I am wholly thine. What a song, eh? Take my life, it is thine own. Take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. Take my heart. It is thine own. It shall be your royal throne. Those are great songs in the 1800s. We fail to write such great songs of the Spirit today. Wow. Breathe on me, breath of God, for I am wholly thine. Oh, Lord. Let me kiss you with the kisses of my mouth. Let me fall down and worship at your feet. When? When all these other interests are vying for my affection. If you then be risen with Christ Jesus, set your affections on things above, not on things of this earth. Simple faith. Simple faith. Pure faith. Away with everything that is not of the Spirit. Away with it. It That's what we say. If it's not laying hold on what God has for us and pressing into the realms of cooperating with Him, it's not worthy of our time. That's what Father's looking for. And His eyes go to and fro throughout the earth seeking someone that He may show Himself mighty on their behalf. And He's not picky. He's just looking for somebody who's ready to fall in love, who's ready to walk out a relationship, who's ready to lay hold on life, who's ready to live in truth, who wants to be real. I want you to just begin to pray along with me. Say, Lord, we just thank You. Begin to just praise Him and thank Him for His goodness, for the empowerment that He's given to you, for His presence in your life. Begin to praise God and thank Him for a traffic jam getting into this place. Yes. Thank Him for signs and wonders and miracles and exploits that He's going to do through your life, through your life. Like that, oh, Lord, we just thank You for the signs and wonders and exploits that You're going to do through Pastor's life. That You're going to give him more anointed Holy Ghost songs. No. That's not the body of Christ. It's every man moving in the... Yes. Tongues, interpretation, tongues, prophecy, miracles, gifts, healing. Everybody functioning in the manifestation of the Holy Ghost. Some of you are going to have to start praying about spending your life in Cuba. Because so many doors are opening in Cuba. Especially after we do the crusade. There's going to be need for miracles, signs, and wonders, people in Cuba. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
People of the Spirit, people of the Word. The churches are going to just explode. It's going to explode. Kashmir, we've got such a... Some of you got to pray about Kashmir. I don't even know what to do with Kashmir. Because we're going to fill this cricket stadium and there are no churches. I've never been to a nation where there are no churches. I understand how to interact with the underground church. You can find the underground church. I can't find the underground church in Kashmir. It supposedly exists. I can't find it. And somebody told me who knew about it said, you don't want to find it, believe me. That it needs to be completely started over. But we just get, well, we're going to churches. The only thing I can think of is to start doing in the cricket stadium every weekend. We'll be back here next Sunday or Saturday or whatever. I don't know how the Lord's going to do it. I don't need to know. He doesn't tell us. He tells us one event at a time. He says, just take the first step. I'll tell you the second step after you've done the first step. Because it's simple faith, it's trusting, it's agreeing with God, and it's absolutely trusting Him. And this is where it all gets worked out. Are you going to trust Him? Because there's all kinds of things that we'll self-justify and say, oh, well, it's, you know, I still trust God. I'm just going to go to the doctor. I love what Richard said the other day. Do we thank God for doctors? Yes, because if we didn't have doctors, half the church would be dead. It's time to start moving in faith. It's time to stay here. Here I stand and I should not be moved.
Amen.
God's my healer, my savior, my deliverer.
Amen.
My way maker, my provider.
Amen.
If He can't get it to me, I don't want it.
Amen.
If I die starving, I'm going to just go into Him and say, Lord, You promised to take care of me. You didn't come through. I guarantee You're not going to do that. Because He's a faithful God. Ain't nobody going to do that. Go and accuse God of unrighteousness. Go and accuse God of not following up. It won't happen.
Amen.
Somebody said, when you get sick and diseased, God's initiating your call home. No, it ain't. I'm not going that way. Amen. Not the initiation. And then they give me all the Bible verses, scriptures to prove it. Hezekiah, Zedekiah, and all the rest of the folks. It's just not true.
Amen.
Kenyon. Well, you know what Kenyon did, right? Cut everybody together and said, okay, I'm going home today. I love all of you. You're so special to me. I don't want to leave any of you. But I'll see you soon. Good night. And he left. That's the perfect way to go.
Yes.
Goodbye. And he bowed his head and left. Instead of bowing his head and praying, he bowed his head and left. People, if you think, if somebody told you it was about over, or somehow you missed the train, where was you? The train is in the station right now, and it is waiting on you to take you into the realms of glorious Holy Ghost maturity, the manifestation of the life and ministry of Jesus to the full. The church is going up.
Yes.
I'm talking to those folks that are watching me right now in Oregon. The church is going up.
Amen.
They're going to go ahead and push the building permit on through.
Woo!
They're going to push it on through now.
Hallelujah!
There's not going to be any of this, what about this and what about that. It's fine!
Yes. Yes. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, for miracles.
I was out there digging them septic tanks until, what was it, 10 o'clock at night the other night.
Yeah, you had dinner at 10.
Septic systems, huh?
You had dinner at 10:30.
But you know, I felt that the Lord was well pleased. I didn't feel like I was violating anything. There was nobody else to do it. And I can dig 100 feet an hour. And there's not a lot of people that can dig 100 feet an hour. And they're going to tell you that if they can dig 100 feet an hour, they're not going to tell you that. Because they can't make money that way. I tell you, it's going to take them a bunch of hours. Praise the name of Jesus. It's going up.
Amen.
They had, I forgot how many people they had saved this morning in the meeting. Like 3 or 4 people saved this morning, something like that. Beautifully. The seed is getting sown. The ranches are getting moved.
Yes.
People are coming. Different people are coming saying, wow. I mean, we had a woman who had been walking with God. She'd been in the area for 50 years. She's like, oh, this is, I mean, she was just going on and on. This is so amazing. God has answered all of my prayers. Oh, praise God. Great things. It was just going on and on and on.
Amen.
And we were just in a little move, just a little meeting.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Millions of people are desperate for Jesus.
Yes.
Desperate to see the move of God. Desperate to see the manifestation of simple, pure,
yes,
uncontaminated,
yes,
faith.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
An agreement with God. An absolute trust with God that's been tried and proven, and it's got to be tried and proven. That's immersed down in love out of a pure heart. That's a powerhouse. Come on, girls. Come on. Come on, guys. Come on, people. Father's called you. He's got his eyes set on you. I want you to stand with me. His eyes are set on you. Isn't that wonderful? Why don't you just dance a little bit? His eyes are set on you. I'm a beloved's and he is mine. I'm a beloved's and he is mine. I'm my beloved's and he is mine. Lord, tonight, settle their case permanently. Lord, tonight, settle their case permanently.
And you know what's so wonderful about it? It would be one thing if he was just saying that. But reality of it, hundreds of thousands of people are there outside and inside, because what's happening is God is settling their cases permanently just over such a simple declaration. That's why people are coming by the masses, because everybody says, we know where you can go to get healed. Whatever the disease, whatever the problem, it'll just happen. Just come and stand in the building. Because somebody laid hold on God. Somebody took hold of a simple faith. That somebody's going to be me. That somebody's going to be you. In the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want God more than my bread. I want God more than my clothes. I want God more than pleasures. I want God more than treasures. I want God more than anything. I want His ways. I want His life. I want His presence more than any other desire.
That's who we are. And that's going to be the shout, and that's going to be the cry until all our expectation in God has been fulfilled.
Till all our expectation in God has been realized.
Don't you weary in well-doing. Many of you have been going out in the streets calling people to come. Some of you going even to pick people up, and yet they don't show up when they said they were going to come, get in the car. Don't you weary in well-doing, because I'm telling you right now, it's the passionate pursuit for the breakthrough. Before long, I'm telling you, you're going to begin rushing and there'll be a traffic jam in the place. There'll be a traffic jam in the place. I consecrate and I dedicate this property to the kingdom of God, for the purposes of the kingdom of God. I claim it in Jesus' name. Men cannot have it. Men cannot use it for their own interests. Settle our case tonight. Permanently.
The governance of men cannot stop the building plan, cannot stop the purposes of God that He has ordained over this land. That which God has spoken, He's called forth the dead to life again. He's called forth the blind to see. He's called forth the crippled to walk. He's called forth those who do not know Him to become intimate with Him.
It shall surely come to pass. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah!
Simple faith. Hallelujah. Prepared unto every good work. Developed. Matured. Strengthened. Established. and the faith to comprehend with all saints what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth. To know the love of Christ, which passes all knowledge, and there inflamed and filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you can think or ask, according to his power that now resides and is at work on the inside of you. Get ready! Get ready! Get ready! Get ready! Get ready for the great outpouring! Get ready for the great moving! Get ready for the lightnings of God, the thunders of heaven, the working of his mighty power! Get ready! Get ready! Get ready! Get ready! I tell you, you've got to want to be left out to miss this. But if you want to lead the way, if you want to be a part of the restorer of the breaches, repair the breaches and restore the paths, restore the places in God to dwell, the building of the ancient ruins, as it were, of living in oneness, hallelujah, empowered in every dimension as sons and daughters of the Most High. That you have to press in. Shut in. Shut everything out that is of this world and of this interest. Shut it with God. Say, Lord, to you alone we look. Hallelujah. I want to encourage you to make sure that you're participating with the miracle of financial provision that God wants to give to you. That God wants to work through you by participating in the things we're doing, especially in building of the church in Oregon. Participate in it. Why? Not because we need your finances, no. What we need you to do is to step into a supernatural, miraculous realm so that you can participate in taking the nations. It's not just one thing. It's not just one event. It's 500 million orphans and a rolling out a plan for them. It's literally hundreds of, it's several billion kids to be educated. And how are they going to get educated? We're just going to hand them off and leave it for the demonic powers to educate them? When Father's given us the power and the ability to step in there and begin to turn it and change culture because somebody's able and willing to move in simple faith. There's a cross to bear. It's a loss of your life to live his life. It doesn't look like it's easy, but I'm going to tell you right now, it's glorious. I want to encourage you tonight. I want you to understand tonight when you give, it's not about we need your finances. It's not about it. When I was speaking to you not too long ago and telling you, you're going out to finance it. You're going out to support it. I'm talking to you about stepping in a supernatural realm, a miracle realm, not out of an earthly. Because you can, none of us here could support what God wants to do out of a human ability. I mean, my goodness, isn't it? Come on. You step in. You get to, there is a way where you get to connect with a miracle through giving, and you do it. Everyone who's learned how to lavishly give has learned how to lavishly receive. And Father just laid on my heart this weekend again. I mean, it's been working in me for a decade, and the Lord said, no, I want you to go on TV. So John Kilpatrick's getting ready to take over God TV, so I'm going on. So I got a hold of Kay, and I believe I got a hold of Elizabeth. So guys, I'm going on TV. We got to get this thing done. So when I said, "What's the budget?" Funny, I never asked. Why are you asking? Rather, you could say, "Isn't it wonderful that the one who owns everything is financing us?" Yeah. And did you notice I used the plural form? Us. Instead of me. Because I know how people might want to do it. Because people want to be lazy. And there's nothing lazy about faith. It goes to work. Faith goes to work. And so I said, you got to hook up with a supernatural supply. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Get ready. I'm not going to tell you the rest of the things that the Lord's laid on my heart to do. I don't overwhelm you. And as you hook up with it, Father's going to lay the same kind of supernatural things on your life. There's so many nations to reach. Somebody needs to go to Tajikistan. Somebody needs to go to Kyrgyzstan. Somebody needs to be in Iran. There's people right now ministering in Saudi Arabia. The Africans are in Saudi Arabia. It's like the Africans, they don't care. I'm from Africa. We're here to do church. Well, you can't do church here. Why? They're just having amazing results. The Africans are taking over the Middle East. In Qatar. So many different places. Dubai. I want a church in Kabul. Kabul, right now. We can have a church in Kabul. Kashmir, much more difficult than Kabul, Afghanistan. Much more difficult, much more dangerous if you're worried about danger. But over here in the simple faith, it's like, we can do this. I'm going to go there and everybody's going to love me. They're going to love me. Because I'm going to bless them. You know what our dear brother Mike does? He's not only visited every house in the town of 400 people in Bly, but he's visited over and over again. And what he does is we now produce quite a few eggs. So he takes people eggs, goes, gives them eggs, and now we got fish, supplying fish. So now he can take people eggs and fish and go visit with them every day and tell them how much he loves them, how much Jesus loves them. I'm telling you right now, that's the kind of stuff we're training him. We branded him. He's tattooed Kashmir. Because he's going to go do the same thing in Kashmir. And there will be tens of thousands of people coming to the kingdom just from one guy taking eggs and fishes and feeding people and blessing people. By the time we build the first greenhouse with the indoor raceway and hatch the first 10,000 trout eggs, there'll be tens of thousands of people saved because they're so inquisitive. They're going to sit there and they're going to come and they're going to watch those little eggs go around in the McDonald's jar until all of a sudden they pop out and they're little teeny fishes. And by the time that's done, they're going to be gathered around. There's going to be 10,000, 20,000 people gathered around waiting for the event of the fish. It's spread like wildfire. There's nothing else to do. Nobody's got any jobs. So, nothing else to do. Hey, they're hatching fish over there from eggs. They're going to grow trout, big trout. We're all going to eat them. From eggs, yeah. The eggs are moving around in a jar. Come watch. And everybody's going to be standing there watching. And we're going to feed them all while they're watching. And we're going to talk to them about the power of the living God, how much Jesus loves them. We're going to bless them. And everybody's going to get saved. And everybody's going to love us because we're there to bless them. And if they say, no, I don't want Jesus, I'm a Muslim, we're going to give them a kiss and a hug and double food. Yeah. We shake the nation of Kashmir. Amen. From the Srinagar to the Jammu Valley. Huh. It's just burning on the inside of me. Yes. Let me just say this, people. God has deposited within our lives and within my life, and we've given it out to you, and as many as you've received it and been willing to walk in it, it's a living word in you. Something that is not redundant, this nation needs to hear. It's not something that everybody else is saying. Why should we be another voice saying the same thing? God has given us a message that is absolutely, by and large, the rest of the church is silent on.
Amen.
And for us not to step up, I had a man of God come to me maybe 20 years ago. No, it's not that long ago, 15 years ago. He said, God has given you things. And I'm just going to tell you, and it's not self-serving. It was Brother McCurdy. James McCurdy, just tell you the name. That is so rare. And unless you get it out there, you'll be held accountable before God for neglect. It's too precious. And I'm telling you, people, I believe that for every one of us. And I pray in the name of Jesus that you can see beyond the interest of your own self.
Yes.
And you'll look at a heavenly vision and say, Father, I'm going to be like Gaius and the rest of those around Gaius that John addressed in his third epistle, who give myself to working to supply the need of the ministry.
Thank you, Lord.
Gaius. He says, you walk in truth. And boy, was that ever big, because he's already laid out what it means on his scale to walk in truth. You are proven to be in the faith. And boy, did he ever lay that out, huh? Gaius, because you live, you give yourself to working to support the ministry and those that are with you. Amen. And I pray and I believe with all of my heart that you not only support what God is doing in this place, but ultimately you sowing in, and you need to be doing it in this way, to yourself go.
Yeah.
To yourself to receive an anointing from heaven.
Yes.
I pray your cry is my cry.
Yes. Yes.
That your cry is the cry of Christ Jesus. Yes. That your ministry is the ministry of Jesus.
Yes.
Who he said, Lord, give me the nations for my inheritance and the uttermost parts of the earth for my possession. That's the ministry of Jesus. That's the cry of the Spirit of the Son. The love of God constrains us to preach in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and the uttermost parts of the earth. The Spirit of the Son has grabbed a hold of us to do thy will, O God. It is written of me. It is already written in your book. Just written. Tonight, if there's anybody in this place, you felt left out, you felt unwanted, you felt like somehow God has passed you by, I break the power of that lie and the distractions that allowed it. The power of that lie and also the distractions that allowed it. For if you'd never been distracted, the voice would have never had place to speak to you such a thing, and you believe it. Now take hold of this life in God tonight.
Yes.
Take hold of this simple faith.
Yes.
Take a hold of this promise that God has given to us, this blessing that he's given to us, this life that he's given to us, agreement with God, trusting God.
Amen.
That a supernatural working of the power of God may be perfected in your life by the gift of God. And then you'll be caught away and received up into glory. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
With great excitement and anticipation. For you could say, I have fully lived for him. I have fully done his will with demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. I withheld nothing of my life to fully live his. Hallelujah. Tonight, if I had an offering basket big enough, we would have all of you step into it. Because this is that kind of meeting. It needs to be that kind of meeting with your life every day, that you're just going into the offering. Thank you, Jesus. Lydia, you're going to do this. Angelica, you're going to do this. Francesca, you're going to do this. Annika, you're going to do this. Zoe, you're going to do this. Jacqueline, you're going to do this. Deborah, you're going to do this. Every one of you, if I've left out your name, you're going to do this. And just highlighting. Hallelujah. Elizabeth, you're going to do this. Elizabeth, you're going to do this. You're going to do this. You're going to do this.
Yes, yes. Thank you, Jesus.
Empowered to do great exploits. Empowered by the Spirit of the Lord. Empowered, signs and wonders, empowered, gifted to display Jesus. Jesus on display. I just want every one of you just to imitate what Elizabeth did. Because I was naming different people and she said, Elizabeth, you're going to do this. Hear that? Don't you leave yourself out to me. I was in a meeting just this past week. Somebody was saying, that's me. You're talking about me now. Yep, that's right. Over here, right here. All right, look at this way. I will do that. I'm doing that. And people might act like it's bragging. It ain't. It's not bragging. It's faith talk. It's supernatural. Praise God. It's wonderful to be in meetings where everybody recognizes that's the voice of the Spirit. They're not, they know, we already know. There's not a disruption. It's like, you know, it's like, yeah. Amen. Amen.